Well, there goes the neighborhood. We're on a different. I'll explain everything. So I'll post it.
No, but can you just put a link to the Fate to Miracle of Long John's in
Oh,
there?
well, my wife is helping me, because for some reason we're having terrible trouble with Facebook. Like, America's having terrible trouble with everything. It's
Facebook.com, capital M, Miracle of Long, and John's are spelled capital.
I don't think that matters.
Okay.
So, yeah, let's do it.
Okay, you
Let's
ready?
do it.
Okay.
See if it'll post.
Okay.
As I will repeat. Oh, see, I'm properly dressed for the
Oh, it
occasion.
linked to the page. Good. Okay.
Did it post?
I'm gonna say, please, friend, and join us.
Yeah. And there were, I don't know if this will stay on or how long this will stay on, but the most important thing about your modern COVID mask is the accoutrement, is to make it special. This is what's going to protect you from COVID-19 and COVID-18 and 17 as well. By the way, I'm Dave Lefkowitz. Welcome. I know we're late, we're about 15 minutes late, but at least we seem to be streaming finally on Facebook, even though I'm not on my regular Facebook page. So if you know people, if you found us here on this miracle of long term, oh, this is great. Just broke the glasses trying to keep them on my face. So it's gonna be actually a really, I had a really wonderful show planned. This always happens when I have one of the best shows planned with everything, real scripted out and some great stuff to do. Everything turns to shit before my eyes. That's my life, ladies and gentlemen.
I'm going to share this.
So let's see if this works. Okay, there we go. Anyway, we're here for the 740th
I'm
edition.
sharing this on the Dave's Gone By, which is the Dave's Gone By timeline that I'll share this post about Dave's Gone By being moved to the new place.
Well, what do you mean by where to do
What's the
it?
original account that people go to? What's it called?
Dave's Gone By.
Okay.
See if it'll post. Yeah,
That's
so
what I'm
that'd be
doing.
great.
Friend, no friend, what's the friend's name?
I beg your pardon?
Dave
Dave's Gone
Lefkowitz.
By.
Dave Lefkowitz
Oh
is
yeah,
the name.
okay, yeah. So what's happened is, let me explain the technical difficulties. And since the only people in this
You're not
room
friends with yourself on
on Miracle of Long Time, I don't know if I can do friends here, but
No.
it won't let me
I'll put for
post to my
Tristan.
own page.
I'm putting it to me.
Yeah. Let me see if I can add friends while I'm
Now it
physically.
says my browser appears offline. See, there's something.
Oh, yeah.
Facebook is having.
It's having issues. So what was happening is on my regular page, Dave's
Oh, wait
got
a second.
what?
I'm in Dave Lefkowitz.
Oh, you
I
already
posted it, yeah,
did
on.
it post?
Yeah, look.
I don't get it. All right, yeah. See if you can go live on that
I'm
page.
gonna try,
And
baby.
if you can, I'll start the show over. And I
Yay.
apologize to all of you who are watching this.
That's fine.
But you know what? I've seen, Broadway people do little concerts and many things as we're all telebroadcasting, as it were. And everybody's having technical stuff, and everybody's not. The people on TV, the newscasters, the weather people are broadcasting from home, and they're having issues and they're having stuff. And
Weathercasters?
yeah, everybody's isolated. Nobody's coming to the studio. People are sitting in their living rooms, crap behind them, not properly lit, not made up in the usual way, and doing what they've got to do. And of course, there's gonna be technical stuff.
Oh, now it says no internet. Maybe that's the.
I'm not getting. I'm Wi-Fi is looking for networks, but we seem to be. Yeah, no, our Wi-Fi's on. Now you're getting a no internet. This is hilarious.
Okay,
Try,
now
keep
I've had
trying.
some. I'm trying.
Yeah.
Calling.
No, but this seems to be going. And it's going to record no matter what. The question is it going out live to anybody? So what we may end up doing is simply recording the show, posting it later, and I'll do a much different version. If nobody's watching live, I might as well just do a recorded show. Make believe. Only make believe. I love you. Only. How's it going? Make believe. Oh no, I dropped the glasses. I love you too. Wouldn't I like to die? Yeah, I've used these glasses before. But anyway, Let me tell you about the program. What's Facebook telling you?
Same dealio.
N saying no internet or just not
No,
letting
it's
you?
saying the error starting a broadcast.
Yeah.
Please
So
return.
I'm on here. I'll
Okay.
do this.
I'm in this one. I'll tell people.
Yeah. Oh, there's somebody, or maybe you're watching me. Somebody just logged in to Dave's Gone By on Miracle
Well,
of
I
Long. It's
said it,
probably
I
you.
believe. Let's see.
On this page. So here's the deal. Facebook is not letting me do the show. In my usual way, from my usual place, from my Dave's
I'll
Gone By
send this to
page.
all your
Please
friends.
do. Please do.
Yeah, I'm gonna send it to everybody.
And this is open, it's public, so you don't have to be a friend of the neighborhood to tune in and watch
Let
me
me see if
here.
I can get there to
Yeah.
here.
And this is the new normal.
Oh, it does go in. Good, it goes in. Good.
Great. Oh, Fred! Hey, Fred from Friendly, you
It
just
goes
joined.
in,
Yay,
yeah.
welcome to Fred.
But I'm gonna send this. You got a lot of, wait.
So the miracle
A
of
lot of
long.
people are writing in, or just, I think they're
Yeah,
already jumping in.
welcome everybody who's now tuning in to the Dave's Gone By Facebook, your podcast, your programming of the stream, with me, Dave Lefkowitz, my darling and adorable and very helpful wife,
I'm
Joyce.
sharing this to st
I was
share
not
with
a,
people.
Facebook was not letting me get online to go
Snooze,
live
snooze,
on our regular homepage. As a matter of fact, last night I was trying to send out and post a reminder about today's amazing, wonderful show, and it wouldn't even let me post that. I was hoping whatever issues Facebook was having would have been resolved by this morning, but of course they were not. So I tried logging on Facebook.com. Dave's Gone By wouldn't let me. I don't know why, but it's letting me do it on Miracle of Long John. So what we'll do is we'll save the program here, post it, of course, in our archives a day or two later, and on the Facebook archive here, and maybe even post it on the Dave's Gone By page on Facebook. But anyway, Fred says, "Good morning, Mr. Miracle." Not sure what that
Yeah,
would.
that Miracle of Long John's
Oh,
shut
Miracle of Long.
down.
Yeah, I can't even think.
Oh, poor
My
honey.
brain is so. My brain is shot from lack of activity.
I
All week I'm lying in bed, just working on my own stuff. I'm not even doing anything that much creative. I'm making sure that the archives of Dave's Gone By are properly working. Because I went through my website and found that a lot of the links to shows were
I'm
broken.
sharing this to all your friends.
Great, thank you.
And I'm saying, please join us on Dave's other FB account due to tech issues. We miss you all.
Yeah, I hope they'll get that. Because they're not going to get that live broadcast, hey,
No,
he's
but
live
they're
thing,
going to
but
get, I sent just a message to all your friends.
that's fantastic.
Yeah.
So hopefully we'll get some people joining, or they'll catch the show as a repeat, as it were. But yeah, I was going to do an update of the show and remind everybody, hey, join us tomorrow morning, and wouldn't let me do that. At least here, for some reason, Facebook does this. It lets me post on one account, but not the other.
No, you're posting on this one, you just can't go live.
Yeah, no, but it won't let me post last night either on that one. It wouldn't let me do anything.
And
So weird.
I just invited everyone separately to all your friends. I did an individual post to all your friends.
Merci beaucoup. Anyway, this is why I wanted to do a show today. This is why I didn't just scrap it, throw the computer out the window and go storming off into the night. I would have waited until nighttime. It would have taken about 12 hours, but then gone storming off into the
But
night.
I'm going to share it public.
Yeah, please do. But I had so much fun stuff to do on this episode of Dave's Gone By. First of all, Rabbi Saul Solomon, the one, the only, the Jewish, Rabbi Saul Solomon, will be with us. He will be talking to a longtime colleague, friendly acquaintance of mine in the theater world, a fellow named Keith Sherman. Now, Keith is and has been a press agent for at least two, probably 3 decades now. He maybe more actually. He's worked on a bunch of Broadway shows. Now, what press agents do is, you've got a Broadway show, you want to tell the world about it. Now, you've got an advertising thing. The producer contacts an advertising agency, and they deal with doing radio commercials and TV commercials and how much money to put in each, and print ads in. Do you take a New York Times ABC column? Do you do this? That's the advertisement department's job. And the producer's job is to raise money for the brand, get all these investors and get enough money to put the show up. And also sometimes the producer puts the whole package together. Producer likes a play a whole bunch, so he signs on the playwright, and he options the play. He so nobody else can produce it, and then he'll pick, with the hopefully with the playwright's blessing, pick which director. and they'll agree on what actors will be in it. So the producer puts that whole world together. That's what they do. What does a press agent do? Press agents are are responsible for promoting a show. A press agent is hired on, first of all, to get the critics in, which was actually more important many years ago than it is now, but still, they're the ones who have to coordinate whom to invite from all the major dailies, from all the magazines, and it's gotten more Wild West out there since the explosion of the internet, of which legitimate critics are writing for all these different websites and blogs and podcasts. How do you invite them? When do you invite them? What dates during previews? Can you get them
When do
in or
you
just
invite
after
them?
opening?
You say like this.
Yeah.
Won't you be? Please won't
Won't you
you
be
be? Won't you be my
my
critic?
critic? That's right.
Yeah.
It's true, and it's true. And you also want to make sure that once the critics review, or even more than reviews, they love the puff pieces, they love the setting up interviews with the cast and the staff and the directors and stuff. They love preview pieces, which are not going to be negative at all. It's just going to be information telling audiences, potential audiences, hey, come see this show. This actor's in it. Come see the show. This playwright wrote it about this, and it's going to be real funny or real scary and so forth. So, they're going to want to get those pieces that are written and produced and broadcast and get them out there and get lines in the quote ads and the print ads. Press agents are also responsible for coordinating all the events involved in a show. If they're going to get the, let's say, the lead actor in a musical is a great singer, right? And they get her to sing the national anthem when there's a baseball game. And then, that's got to be coordinated. That just doesn't sort of happen magically. She's not in the stands about to watch the game, and they call her over. Can you stand up and just sing the national anthem? Somebody's got to deal with that. Somebody's got to deal with if the play wins awards and or is nominated for awards and getting the people where they have to be. Press agents do a whole bunch, and they do stunt things. Those are the most fun. Keith Sherman has a story about frogs that I hope he will tell Rabbi Saul later in the show. A story about frogs involving a Broadway show. That's the fun stuff that press agents have been doing for decades, and they probably do a bit less of now. But if you need a show that really wants to get out there and promote itself and rise above the 30-something other shows on Broadway, sometimes they need a gimmick. Sometimes they need to do something weird or special or goofy or just like, oh, cool. They're opening the stock market this morning. The cast of the show are. They're on, the Jimmy Fallon show or on Jimmy Kimmel. They're performing a number. Press agents are involved in all of that as well. So it's a very, very busy
Uh-oh.
job. And sometimes it's a wonderful
I
job
need
if
to
you have
tell
a
that
hit.
gem to log in on another browser. I want to
Oh,
see if I can do it. So
sure,
it
yeah.
wants a code.
Yeah, do I can what? What about browser?
I'm trying to log in on another browser, so it wants
Oh,
to.
see if you can. But anyway, that's some of what a press agent
Uh-oh. It wants your
does.
email code, David. Hovo at AOL.
Okay, I can write
Okay.
it down for you,
Yeah,
but I
do
can't
that.
say it right here, that's for sure. Hold on, I've got to write something down. I'm going to do it on a scrap paper. Well, you know what? You guys hold tight while I play
Just write
the
it on
theme
here. Don't write
music.
it. I'll write it there.
Yeah.
I'm damned to get you in here now.
I know, right? I think this is it. Can you read this? Yeah. Forgive me. Yeah. Here we go.
Thank you.
So Keith Sherman has been a press agent now, as I said, for a couple of decades, doing what press agents do. And he's also trying to do it right this second in the midst of our global pandemic. So he's trying to hold his office together. He's a small
Is it just a double digit number?
triple.
Okay.
It's
Okay, no, I got it.
got, okay.
No, I don't got it.
And on top of all this, on top of there being no Broadway shows at the moment, and not going to be any Broadway shows likely until maybe June. Nobody set that yet.
David,
Nobody said that out loud.
I know the word. What's the number? Yeah, but it's.
Yeah, I think so. You know what? Hold on. I'm gonna try and do something here. Because off the top of my head, I'm being asked to do things that I normally do
If
automatically.
you give me a code, then
Yeah,
I can I'm
I'm literally
trying.
gonna see if that's the one that works.
Okay.
Just give me a second,
Or
folks.
just log
Thank
in.
goodness you can't see my screen right now.
Just log in and give me a code, baby.
But that is the pass. What the hell? Just give me a moment, folks.
You should get a
Yeah,
code.
that is the correct password.
Can you give me numbers if you're entering the account?
Hold on.
Write down the security code.
Oh, I see what it did. Okay,
Yeah.
I will. I will. Give me a second. Again, for you know what, folks, while this is going on, let me play our opening, our intro music,
Yeah.
so that we can start the show proper. Half hour late, Dave's gone by.
There goes the neighborhood. And there was much rejoicing.
Didn't your meds kick in yet?
We got David Lefkowitz is here. He's a Long Island arts guy. He's got his own radio show.
I want you all to really enjoy a wonderful program done by a fine artist.
A glorious thing of unparalleled beauty.
Dave's gone by. Dave is one of my very favorite broadcasters, so keep on listening to Mr. Dave.
I mean, I'm not going to start a new password that I can't. In every color of day, whirling around it. So what is the problem now with Facebook and with AOL and with everything else? What's the deal?
So it shows that you're alive there, see?
Fantastic. So, what does it need from me?
Nothing.
Great.
Oh, and I reached 341 people,
Good
apparently,
Lord.
with six engagements.
There's more people than we've ever reached before
And I
on
don't
this
know, what does
show.
that mean that I reached 341 with six
We get
engagements?
that sometimes with the UNC Radio one, where because it's a business, it's not a personal page, it's more of
And it
an
says boost
organization page.
unavailable.
Oh, well.
What is the boost?
Boost out, well, you have to pay for that.
Okay.
You sort of I think it's sort of like an advertising thing. Facebook will boost the profile of what you're doing, but it's like advertising, it's like promotion. It's like what Keith Sherman does with his shows on Broad. So you see the see the connections we make here? Anyway, welcome to those of you who normally watch on my other channel. We're using the Miracle of Long John's channel. By the way, Miracle of Long John's, we haven't even explained, was the name of my solo show that I did a couple of years ago. God, a few years ago now, off Broadway. It won an award at the United Solo
You look
Festival.
beautiful, honey.
Thank you, guys. You looking good? Yeah.
Yeah.
So this was the page on Facebook that was created for that solo show, which, by the way, I am available to do distance for you at some point, or back when people are going into theaters again. Been wanting to do that show again. But anyway, here we are. We're doing this radio podcastio programmio of the stream called Dave's Gone By. With me, Dave Lefkowitz, my darling, adorable wife, Joyce. We just had a thumbs up from someone, whoever.
I keep sharing it to people.
Well, thank you. Subhash. Thank you, Subhash.
Hey, Supash.
Oh, and the one thing I forgot to mention about Keith Sherman is that while he's trying to hold his business together, and there's no Broadway or off-Broadway shows out there. So, he's got staff that he's trying to keep paid at least for another couple of weeks and figure out things to do.
Sherman.
Yeah, Sherman, Keith Sherman of the Keith Sherman Associates Agency. Through all this, the guy has COVID. And we're going to talk to him about that, and if he's exhibiting any symptoms, or if he's over it, or if he's currently, bashing through it.
Tell
So,
him, listen,
yeah.
my mom's a retired nurse. My mother was telling me that they called all medical personnel,
Yeah.
and my mother was a nurse when they gave women capes. And I said, that's exactly what you want in a nurse. She said, we couldn't wear pants. They made us wear a white hat and a cape. I said, that's exactly what you want. Somebody who can't move their arms, can't squat, and has to worry about their hat falling off. Yeah.
Yeah, what was that? You see that in old shows.
I think they made them do that so they looked like nuns. Because the original nurses, a lot of them were nuns. But poor, I can call mom and take care of Keith.
Yeah, maybe, or I wonder if they could maybe turn the cape this way if somebody's vomiting or bleeding
no
on
way.
You. No, it always stay on your back like a Batman thing. I don't know.
Okay, so I'm sharing. Please join us as press agent Keith Sherman joins the DGB neighborhood.
Yeah, well, Keith will be with us, God willing, if his his technology is working in about a little less than an hour from now. On Dave's Gone By. So he'll be there with Rabbi Saul Solomon. We also have so much other cool stuff to do on the program. We have a Colorado Limerick of the Damned, because Joyce and I used to live in Colorado for a few years, and I've been doing horrible little poems about all these different places in Colorado. Today, we're going to be going to Delhi, Colorado. Yes, there's actually a planet spelled just like the Indian place, New Delhi, D-E-L-H-I, Delhi, Colorado, for our Limerick of the Damned. We'll go inside Broadway. There's not much to talk about theater-wise on that segment, except a couple of people who died this past week. So much fun. And then we have our Today Yesterday quiz. This is kind of nice. We have, since today is April 4th, in our quiz, we like to go through April 4th throughout history. So, there's been an April 4th in 2019, there was one in 2018, there was one in 2018 BC. We don't know what happened on that date. I imagine somebody, put two rocks together and bashed a...
Facebook, it's...
A dinosaur in the head or something like that.
Facebook.
But it's our Today Yesterday quiz, a trivia quiz about April 4th. And then what else do we have? Oh! We have another Wretched Pun of Destiny, ladies and gentlemen. This is a chock-full episode, I'm telling you. A Wretched Pun of Destiny, and the subject will be darkroom equipment. Darkroom equipment. We'll have a terrible pun that will have to do with darkroom equipment. You don't want to miss that. Did I miss anything else? And of course, Greeley Crimes at All Times. Which, weirdly enough, they're still posting.
David, it's facebook.com, Miracle of Long John's, right?
Yeah, is our page. So, facebook.com/...
This way, right?
Yeah. Like, the head of the slash is tilting this way.
Right.
Let me see. That looks perfect.
Okay, good.
Yeah.
I'm sending it, like, many, many times, so people join late.
Yeah. Well, no, but the weird... This is... Everybody always, when... People first started using the web. Everybody used backslash. And to me, a backslash looks like this. Well, except because because our video is a mirror image, it's probably giving you a forward slash as you're watching it. But backslash, in my mind, would be kind of like the seesaw is down. The hell with this. I can't even put this in my head to talk about this in a proper way. I'm just saying I'm very careful to say forward slash because it's sort of the head of the slash is going to 2 o'clock rather than 10 o'clock. Does that make sense? I know it doesn't. Anyway, what else? What else? What the hell is there to talk about on a day like this, in a time like this in America? You all have your masks, right? It was going to be such a great opening to the show if Facebook had allowed me to do it. I wasn't even going to be showing up. It was going to be my friend Potato. Look how beautiful he looks. Ow, my eyes! Look how gorgeous Potato looks.
You should not be sharing a mask with him.
Really?
No.
I'm not going to get blight. Or is he going
to
get my...
He wants me to log into Facebook.
Did you get logged out?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, well. But yeah, I don't know. Facebook, I don't think it's our internet. I think,
no.
Oh my gosh, I forgot totally to plug in my computer, so we're running on battery here. Hold on, folks. I'm going to do this. Dude.
I don't know which is my account.
Ta-da! The hilarious part is, I've been doing this Facebook show for a good 2.5 years now. Literally, I've just been going live on Facebook in the mornings.
I'm restarting.
For years. So I should be used to this shit. And meanwhile, everybody who's just started to deal with it in the past week and a half is doing better than I am.
You know, but now we found out at least you can share the screen on Facebook. That's
pretty cool because we've got a Zoom A week ago, our guest in the neighborhood was the marvelous cartoonist and
Ben
illustrator
Ketchum.
Ben Catcher.
But
Thank you.
now we know how to
Yeah.
share.
But during the show, we couldn't have Ben Catcher was talking to Rabbi Saul on Zoom, which is this app where you don't have to download anything, you just join it, and you don't have to pay anything. It's really, really neat. It's like the next iteration of Skype and so forth. But it was great, except we couldn't really do it during the live show. If you go now to the archived video on davesgoneby.com, I've cut in the Zoom video where you see both Ben and the rabbi. And that's much more interesting visually than just one camera on the rabbi or me if I'm doing an interview. So that's really, really cool. We didn't know if Facebook would allow us to do that. Apparently it does. So we may try that even next week, try a Facebook thing where instead of a Zoom, where
Yeah.
we can go back and forth and show both people during an interview. So as a matter of fact, next week, fingers crossed, we got actress Annie Golden, who's going to be on the program. She
Wants
was
me to
in,
log in.
oh dear, yeah. She was in the movie of Hair, and she's done a ton of
You don't know
Broadway,
what my
like Broadway.
password is for the Joyce Weil PhD account.
For Gmail?
No, for my Facebook.
Oh, you have a Facebook? I
Okay,
can.
forget it. No, it's
This
okay.
is the
Never
face that
mind.
says, I have no idea.
That David, I'm not that good at stuff, but I would say that's a no.
Yeah, that maybe I might, but let me see. And again, I couldn't do this if we were zooming because you see my.
Zoom isn't no, only if you share the screen. You could do it if you're zooming. It's only if you screen share.
I don't have it on
Okay, don't
my
worry about
receiving.
it. I
Let's
don't.
just enjoy the show. Let's
I
just do
am.
the
I'm on
show.
Facebook.
Yeah. Oh, you're back on Facebook and let
I'm
you back.
off for.
Oh.
But I sent the thing to a lot of people,
Yeah.
and it said those 365. We don't have as many friends on PA. Is there a way that we could take all the friends we have at my account and make them in? You
I
should
don't
have
think you can.
done it from my account.
Oh, enjoy. Well, it's supposed to be that's your personal whatever.
No, that's really both of ours.
Yeah.
If I can find out the
Well, we can do
password.
that next time
Yeah,
if there's
let's
an
do
issue,
that
because
the
I want to
next
finish it. I
meeting.
want to do the show right here that we're doing.
Okay.
And again, I apologize. I mean, this has nothing to do with Joyce or me or even Potato.
Yeah.
I blame Corona. I blame coronavirus for
I
Facebook
blame Poo Flume.
and. Oh, wait. If I can do this, if I can actually get this going today on Dave's Gone By and make this all work. And you know what? I'm not even recording because the audio went out before.
Oh, just do it now.
I am.
Okay.
But one thing I forgot to mention is that we have. Cannot record? Why can't it not record? We'll try again. Now it's recording. Thank you. We have a
You know
new
who will help you here? Hold
song.
on, hold on.
Now, do you want to explain what this is?
Have them read it. They can read it.
Now, this seems like an ordinary run-of-the-mill dyed-in-the-wool potato. It is not, because he saw himself in the screen one time on the computer, read this backwards because of the mirror image, and he has become Ogatop.
Yes, Ota top top toppy. He's an Egyptian leader of the potatoes.
So he has special, I don't know if he has any special powers, but he has a
But he has
magnetism.
delusions of grandeur.
Yeah, he's Hitlerian in
I
that way.
believe that he saw the other potatoes wearing a pink tutu dancing.
Oh, we have to mention, we have to talk about this. Well, you got now, I don't know why. My mother is probably in love on some level with Andrew Cuomo, right?
You know why? You know why? Because he's like a big macho bull on parade. He's like, here's what we need to do.
Yeah.
He's like a teamster. Like, you don't want to mess with him. And even though he may not know the stuff, he has an air of like confidence, you know? Even though he's like, yeah, you know. They're
And
like,
he's old school Italian, like this
yeah,
is what it's gonna be, and he's very
yeah,
clear and very
yes.
precise, and unlike our president, who is clear but repeats everything 12
No,
times
but
to make
also is
us.
like just not clear and doesn't has no basis in scientific
Well,
knowledge.
that
And I'm just
too,
like,
yeah. So Andrew Cuomo has been giving these daily updates, just as Trump has, but these daily updates on New York's situation
Yeah.
in the
But
corona.
actually mostly the city. I think he focuses on that, don't you think? It has a city focus
It
to
has a
it.
story of it, but he's the governor.
I
He's not the
know,
mayor.
but
He's not de
it
Blasio.
feels to me very city focused.
Well, because the cluster, the
Yeah.
big problem is in New York City. You know, and you look up on where COVID is, they've got one case in Amagansett.
Oh, wow.
Or just way out on the island,
That's
one case.
somebody's serving
Yeah, but
Amagansett.
like 400 cases in Woodmere, you know,
Oh, I
or something like
know.
that,
That's
and 50
bad.
in Hewlett and all of that.
Wow.
But in New York, they've already had their 1,000th death. New York City, when I say New York, I mean
And Sinai,
Manhattan.
so I love Mount Sinai. I actually worked at Mount Sinai, and I love the physician. I mean, even many of the units there, I know folk, but they've turned Central Park to basically like what the UN used to do. It's like a field hospital,
Yeah.
right? They used to,
It's a MASH unit, essentially, yeah.
It's a triage unit.
No!
Oh, David, David, David.
You used the word! The word
Oh
MASH
no, oh
sets
no.
him off.
Oh no.
No!
Oh no, wait a second, hold on.
Did you use the evil word? No! I'm sorry. It's a
Uh-oh.
mobile, isn't it?
They're mad, wait.
It's a, let's make believe it's Navy. It's a Minch, you know,
Don't go
Mobile
yet. Just
Navy
go
Search
off
for
the topic of David. They're
Minch.
all going to start crying, and there's like hundreds of
All
them.
right,
Oh, and your
okay.
mother's doll is giving me the crazy eye. Oh, sorry, honey.
So here's the deal, folks. So my mother, just like, and her hearing's not so great, so she's up against like the kitchen television like this, like, listening to every golden word that Andrew Cuomo is saying. She also watches all the Trump. She has like from 8 in the morning until 6 at night. It's just nonstop MSNBC, CNN, which I guess is better than nonstop Fox. But it's just everywhere. Like the next sentence is somehow going to be the clue to everything that's been going on. It's going to be the one answer of how you don't get COVID. It's the one answer of how you're not going to fucking die over the next month, right? Is it like the next thing Andrew Cuomo
No,
says?
I think it's like I was telling my trainer and a bunch of other people that everybody's going through, and my sister too, a little bit of PTSD and grief.
Oh, well,
So
yeah.
people are handling it in their own ways, you know. Thus my question of Colorado and legalized marijuana or drugs or drinking, or people are handling it, I'm sure
Oh.
gambling, like people are doing, eating, they're doing excessive, because it's like
Excessive masturbation. Sorry, yes. No such thing, by the way. Yeah.
let's not talk about the
Yeah,
tan.
we can
Let's
talk
talk
about
about
that.
no,
We can talk about
I'm
everything
not
here.
talking about nothing. No,
Okay.
I don't want to discuss that.
But here's the deal, right? People deal with their own
No,
way.
you're talking about the
I'm talking about the
tutu.
brothers. Yeah.
So the brother, I'm sure that the
Yeah.
brothers have, like every family has an in joke. Every family, I'm sure the discussion that the young Cuomo had is basically bringing the family joke live and kind of needling his brother a little bit, teasing him.
Right.
That's probably a family joke.
Well, and is Andrew Cuomo, the governor of New York State,
Yeah.
is he a bachelor or divorced or something like that? What's his
I know
deal?
that, so this is just an aside,
Yeah,
but
yeah.
I love Forest Hills, you know that. And some of the old like Germanic houses I looked at, and they're billions of dollars, right? We can't afford them,
Right.
but Andrew Cuomo, or one of the Cuomos lives there. I don't know which one. Maybe the
Well, they're
younger.
both. One is the governor, the
Yeah.
other's a star on MS or
I
CNN.
forget
Yeah,
which one,
so.
but one of them lives there with his wife and kids, so
Yeah.
one of them's married. I don't know.
Oh, yeah. No,
Yeah.
I think Chris has like this smoking hot wife.
Oh,
She's
then maybe,
yeah.
then that's
But
it.
Andrew might have been married, divorced, whatever he's got. But okay, so that's a little bit of backstory in terms of like press conference happening.
David, do you think, should I move my appointment out of here at 1:15 so you have
No,
time
we're
to
gonna
do?
finish
Okay,
this.
okay,
I will be
okay,
finished, by the way,
okay,
believe
okay.
me.
So they're
So
doing the press conference.
they're doing this press conference, typical Andrew Cuomo press conference. Here's how many have cases. Here's how many dead. This is how we're trying to get some ventilators, and we're dealing with here to get ventilators, and there and we're using. Well, they're taking one ventilator and using them on two people, which is fantastic. They're gonna start using ventilators on eight people, like extra
Like an
tubing.
octopus.
Yeah, I mean, really, it'll be a ventipus. Wouldn't that be wonderful?
Too soon.
Like eight tubes coming out of a thing. We call it a ventipus. And everybody gets just enough oxygen to breathe. Not
It's
comfortably.
just a hookah. They could make
Oh, I
a
could use a hookah right
they
now.
could make a hookah that's a ventilator hookah where they all connect,
Yeah,
yeah.
basically, that's what it is. Is instead of taking in Turkish, Sinsemilla, whatever the hell they do, you're taking just friggin' air. And delete it, apparently. Right? And hearing, oh, at the moment, we've got 6 days worth of ventilators in the bed, enough for the next 6 days. It's sort of like Hanukkah.
That's
It's a
right.
COVID version of Hanukkah.
That's
Yeah,
right.
we have enough stuff for 6 days right now, and if we keep
Yeah.
it rolling, we
But
might.
if we pray to Hashem, we may make it to 20.
Well, Andrew Cuomo would not say that. I don't think he is that.
Andrew Cuomo is gonna do my, and I grew up there, and actually this woman still, thank God, is alive. Her name is Miss Arlene, and she ran a dance studio, and I
Yeah.
think that Andrew might have known her.
Oh, this was the beautiful thing. So you're watching, and you're just getting bad news and bad news and little pockets of hope and bad news and bad news and bad news. And then, right, and that's what it is. We're in the crest of the curve
That's
right this
right.
second, and glued to the television set. And I'm just down there trying to make a little lunch and not wanting to fucking deal because
Right.
if I want a little COVID information
Yeah.
over the course of the day, I'll check Yahoo News, I'll check AP News, I'll check MSNBC, but I don't need to have the
I
channel
know.
or two or three channels
Yeah.
on
Yeah.
all day
And you know
long.
what mom said? What upsets my mother is
Yeah.
like, so my mother's a nurse, right? She can handle this stuff. But she's like, you know, sometimes you want a respite, so why do they have to like cut in? And she's like, unless it's something earth-shattering,
Yeah.
they don't need to cut into your TV shows. For people who have cable and don't have Netflix, they're forced to watch when it comes on because every channel has it.
Okay, well,
You
no, I mean,
know, I
I
mean,
understand that my mom and
yeah.
dad, they're watching the news, they're watching the
No, but
24-hour
some
news talk
people, like
channels.
my mother, wishes to watch. She loves soap operas, like Didi. They
Well, when
like
the
soap
president
opera.
goes on, they
Yeah,
cut
or you know,
in,
so like, I think you could have a crawl, unless it's like earth-shattering, have a crawl and let people enjoy their, give people the
Well,
roots they need,
as
right? Give
I've been
them,
saying on
yeah.
here, but as I've told you, one of the blessings
Yeah.
is that 7 o'clock in the evening,
Yeah.
Jeopardy goes on.
Yes.
Jeopardy goes on, and nothing interrupts Jeopardy, and that breaks the
Even with my
spell.
parents, isn't
Yeah.
that funny? Jeopardy, yeah, and also Wheel of Fortune, not so much. Patch Sajak is looking Trumpy.
Yeah,
He's
but
like,
it
okay.
follows Jeopardy, so they keep it on,
Yeah,
right? It's,
yeah.
Wheel of
That's
Fortune
sad.
sucks,
Like a sloppy second.
yeah. It shouldn't be like Who Wants to Be a Millionaire would be a better lead out of
Something
Jeopardy.
more thoughtful with, well, maybe not. Maybe first you think and then you do wordplay.
Or Concentration, maybe. Remember that one
Oh
with
my
rebuses
God.
across the thing? So,
Or Pornhub.
or what? Or
Pornhub.
Pornhub? Well, definitely Pornhub. That everybody was just hell with Andrew Cuomo. There's these big Italian studs with meat like this,
So tell him his story. What did he
Well,
say?
that's what I'm getting to. But I want to set this all up so
Okay.
that but it is nice that the spell is broken by Jeopardy. After that, after
Yes.
all day of watching nothing but this cycle of
Or
repeated
doing
bad
work all
news,
day.
then, no more of this. I'm gonna put on a fun game called Jeopardy, and I'm gonna watch Wheel of Fortune. And then for the rest of the night, it's regular television. It's NCIS. It's
Yeah.
whatever else the show, Young Sheldon, or whatever the hell else the shows are on regular TV that I don't even watch at this point.
We don't watch regular
So that's a
TV.
blessing. It really is a blessing, because otherwise the news cycle would never stop
But
for a lot of
it's
people.
unhealthy. It's
Yeah.
unhealthy because, you know, it's like you get desensitized and you get paralyzed. I think you have to, it's like one of my coworkers who they think might have been sick. I basically said, this is what my mother said. You know, stay well. If you get sick, it's like a virus. You have to hydrate, no white sugar, sleep,
No white sugar.
eat well, take Tylenol, take a
You
decongestant.
lost me at no white
No,
sugar.
but take a decongestant, you know, try to keep the fever down, stay well. And if you're really sick, go to the hospital. That's all you can do. Go in the shower and put the heat, the,
Oh.
como se dice, the,
Well, make it really
put
hot so
on
you
the
steam.
steam or have it, like we have the humidifier. Do those things that you treat yourself the best you can, and that's what you can do. And then
Because
if
it's not
you're,
curable. And then they said they're working on a vaccine.
yeah,
How exciting.
no.
A vaccine that they might be able to test in October.
No.
Thank you.
What I like the Mount Sinai is doing in other hospitals is they're asking people who have had COVID and gotten over it to donate blood so they can use the blood of people who had it into other folk to see if they can get some immunity to it. So people are trying. I
Oh,
mean,
yeah. Yeah.
they have a whole thing where they're texting healthcare workers to see every day if they're exposed. Like they're trying to research and do it, but it's like I told my people that I have worked with. Sometimes in a crisis, it's like flying the airplane while you're building it. So you can't.
I love
you
that.
Just,
I love that,
that
metaphor.
Is from,
yeah.
That's from a copy
or analogy.
Called
yeah,
Juliet.
Yeah.
It's from one of the books she gave me about rehabilitative counseling, where that's sometimes the experience of a young counselor, right? You're learning how to counsel while you're counseling. So it's the same experience. You can't. You have to do the best you can.
Learning to fly an airplane while you're building it is brilliant.
It's like,
I
and
love
that's
that.
What I feel I'm doing for most of my life in general. So.
Tell me about no, but I mean that's very true. We're all just, and we can't expect. I mean, that's the thing. 2 weeks ago, Trump is saying, "Well, this we're very excited about this malaria. Have you heard about it in 2 weeks? I mean, they're trying."
Let me just people to understand this. Donald Trump is not a scientist. Donald Trump is not a does not have a PhD. Donald Trump does not study retroviruses.
Wait. Hold on a second.
Yeah.
If Donald Trump does not know about chemistry and science, how do you get his skin so orange?
That's a bad experiment. But I really feel like you have to, like, it's like if you want to fix your car, you don't go to the gardener, you go to a mechanic, right? So if you want to learn about something health-based, you should go to one of the, you know, the Surgeon General, you should go to the CDC. Those are the people who have degrees and study this. NIH, NIA, you don't go to...
Well, no, that's why everybody was also in love with Fauci.
Yeah, but you don't go to, you know... You don't go to someone who discredits science, right? I mean, you can't...
No, the guy who doesn't believe in global warming.
Yes.
You don't go to him for advice about a pandemic. It's
or
like,
the person who's like, you know, that social science is fake and all that. Like, if he's saying that, he's not a good resource. You need to understand, you have to... The first thing you teach students when you teach them to think critically about social science or science is to really be critical of the source. So... Mm. If I'm talking about brain surgery, you say, well, Joyce has a PhD, but she's not a brain surgeon.
Yeah, of course.
Right? So if I'm talking about theater or you know, it's not me. If you with an MFA talk about theater, it's different. The source is different.
Well, sure, yeah.
So you have to be critical and say, what does he know? And why is he yelling at scientific people who are saying things based on scientific research?
I know.
You know, when you go to a scientific conference, I present something, people don't yell out, you're crazy. That's
well,
crazy.
No. At conferences, there will be outliers who are.
But they're going to say, based on my findings, based on this, they'll critique your work, but it's with an educated guess. You can't. You have to look at the source of information. Yeah. That's like step one.
No, but we want to believe that our leaders are picking and listening to the right people so that their mouthpieces for, because, you know, Barack Obama's not an expert on global warming or Gore became
Barack
one.
Barack Obama was an educated man.
Yes.
Who used research and data and science.
Right.
So he's different.
But if he's speaking, he's still speaking through the people who researched it that gave him their findings, as should Trump.
He's not yelling at them saying they're wrong and that he's going to say what to do.
Not in public. Yeah.
He wants him to say, you're wrong. That's not professional.
Really? No. Donald Trump acting in an unprofessional way.
You don't yell out and say, you're wrong.
Yeah. I mean,
and you don't attack reporters who are doing their job.
No
this
kidding.
This is a free press, right?
Yeah. Oh, I mean, just the press conference are hysterical sometimes.
Yeah.
They're just, I'm like, really? Really?
It's like the Dirty Dozens. He's like, your mama, how can you ask that? What's wrong with you? It's like a
shame
attack.
On you. Shame
it's
on you
attack.
For asking a question.
Yeah, it's attack. It's like...
You know,
it's like guilty, yeah.
But here's the deal. Here's the deal. We're getting to the core
of
it.
Honey.
By the way, it's 10 o'clock in the morning Eastern time. Well, we started like 9:20, but it's 10 o'clock in the morning Eastern time here in the neighborhood for the Dave's Gone By Facebook, your podcast, your programio of the stream with me, Dave Lefkowitz, my darling and adorable wife, Joyce Potato, who is still thank God healthy because he mostly wears his mask. Ow. You covered all my eyes.
Well, actually, potatoes really don't leave their house. They've not been.
They haven't been exposed.
They've been in the house for a long time. Yeah.
Unless we've given it to them.
They are multiplying, though. You can actually switch your camera, but don't do it. Yeah. There are a lot of them.
But welcome. Welcome to all of the folks who have tuned in from wherever you normally watch on our Dave's Gone By page to watch
us
here.
I put it on your feed that due to technical difficulties, we're now streaming the program through PAI.
Just this week.
Keith Sherman's going
to
join us.
Not PAI, Miracle of Long John's.
Yeah, I'm sorry. Yeah, Miracle of Long John's. And that Keith Sherman's going to join us.
Keith Sherman, the press agent, will be talking with Rabbi Saul Solomon a little later in the program. As a matter of fact, we have titled this episode of the show Sherman's April. Get it? Because it's like Sherman's March, only it's April, and Keith Sherman is the guest. It's our 740th broadcast, not our most auspicious.
David, you never talked about the tutu.
Well, that's what I'm getting. I wanted to give the hour you
Oh,
know,
the marker.
would
Okay.
come up on the
I'm
hour
trying
break.
again with this sucker.
It is, I don't even think I mentioned that. It's the first Saturday in April, April 4th, 2020. Dave's Gone By. Now, I'm talking with Joyce. We can't not talk about the disease and all of
No.
that, but we're trying to do it in a fun way and the most
Yeah.
fun. Let me recap a little bit. So, my mom watches incessant updates and news about the virus and MSNBC and CNN and all of that.
Yeah.
She watches and she loves watching the Cuomo, the Andrew Cuomo, the governor of New York, his updates on the whole situation. He does one every day, like middle of the day.
Do you
And
think SNL is going to spoof it? They probably spoofed it already, right?
don't know if they could. They haven't been able to do, have they been doing live
We
shows?
got to spoof it.
I know that with
Next
potatoes.
time,
Yeah.
yeah. Oh, we have one that has.
Exactly.
Next week
Yeah.
we'll do a reenactment when you're back on
But I
your
don't know if you
thing.
were watching yesterday, I think it was, when
Yeah.
Andrew Cuomo is doing his spiel, and he also says, "Hey, look, by the way, I'm sure you all know that my brother, who's on CNN or MSNBC, one of those two networks,
Yeah.
a big popular fella, he does the show every day, and he has COVID. We've all been terribly worried about him. He has coronavirus, the disease." And people have been asking, "Oh my gosh, how's he doing?" Because they want to know for him, because they like him. They want to know for his family, and they also want to know for themselves. It's like, hey, you know, if I may come down with this, what is in store for me? Assuming I
Yes.
live, assuming
Yeah.
that I get symptoms, but you know, I get okay afterwards. What are the symptoms like? What do I have to
That's
worry about?
true.
So he says his brother Chris is doing better, significantly better. He's
Thank
still got
God.
it. He's still quarantined, obviously. And the great news is that Chris it can be with us on this Zoom-like feed, what Joyce and I were just talking about with
Yeah.
two screens, so we can see him. And so there he is. He puts his brother side by side on the screen. This is live going out. And Chris, first of all, looks great. He's got a little, sort of a baseball cap on, like we're fighting COVID together.
Well,
Fantastic.
because
He looks
he
terrific.
didn't probably wash his hair.
Well, maybe that could be it. But you know, everybody was able to take a big of a breath of relief at that point because we didn't know if he looked like Skeletor. And he comes on, he looks exactly and sounds like Chris Cuomo. Seems like, oh, okay. You know, it's not a death sentence. You know, like the way, not to make this analogy, but the way AIDS was in the first couple of years, where you get it, you're gone, it's horrible. For some people with COVID, you get it, you're gone, it's horrible. For others, not necessarily. It hits so many people in so many different ways, but at least we look at Chris Cuomo and go, oh, he seems okay. He's doing okay. And he looked fine and he spoke fine. But his
Maybe
brother
not.
asked him, how were you during the worst of the disease? And he said, oh, it was bad. You know, I had chills, I had a big fever, aches and pains and this. And here's the most beautiful part. And I'm just so grateful that I was downstairs in the kitchen for this part, making food while this was happening. And Chris Cuomo says to his brother, the governor of New York, who is giving an update on the most serious pandemic that we've had since, probably since the smallpox epidemic that was wiping out children decades ago, right? And, well, I mean, and AIDS, of course, AIDS. But Chris
Yeah.
says, so in the midst of this, when I had the fever, I had a dream.
Oh no.
Okay. And this is not like a
Oh
Martin Luther King,
no.
I've been to the mountaintop dream. No. I mean, there's elements of it. It's a hopeful dream, which is why I'm sure he brought it up. But he says, and in this dream, it was like a Dorothy moment. You were in it, brother. Brother, Governor Andrew Cuomo. I was in a fever dream. And you were in it, Andrew. And you were wearing
Oh.
a ballet costume of some sort.
Yes, of
This is a
course.
direct quote. I first thought he said a ballerina costume, which was totally
A
like,
little
I nearly
different.
lost it right then and there.
A little different, yeah.
You were dressed in a strange ballet costume. And you were dancing around waving a wand. And
Jesus.
you had a look at his brother at this moment,
He's
going,
like,
you know, trying to smile, trying to give that, like, you
yeah,
know,
he's like,
tolerant,
I'm
big
gonna
brother
get
smile, like,
you.
yeah. Tell
Yeah.
everybody watching, millions of New Yorkers watching this right now, what you were dreaming about me in a tutu and a magic little sparkly wand dancing around.
That's great.
And then of course, Chris tried to put a nicer button on it and say, well, what you were doing was you were telling me it's going to be okay. You're going to be all right. And then you spun around and danced away. That is a quote. You can, and if you do not believe me, there is video of that. I mean, don't watch it right now because you're watching me, but there is video of this. And then I'm sure bunches of news sources wrote about this live on the show. And the only way that his brother, Governor Cuomo, could pull it together was to say, yeah, okay, interesting metaphor there. Lots to unpack. And then, of course, they say, I love you, I love you. You said that they've had quite a snipey rivalry.
I wonder, because to me that's like, I don't have like a blood sibling. I call someone my sister, but I wonder, like, that to me seemed a little bit like meow, you know, a little bit like there's some history there.
Yeah. I mean, I think they do love each other.
Yeah.
I think they do.
Of course.
Under it all, they're Italian brothers. They're like this.
We don't know.
But it's also, you know, Corleone-ish. There's, I don't remember. There's
Fredo?
The James Caan.
Yeah.
Was he Fredo? No, Fredo was Fredo was the little brother, right. And then there's...
Yeah.
But you know what I'm saying. You know where I'm going with this. But that's a beautiful moment, man.
I saw you wearing a beautiful...
I dreamed I saw Andrew Cuomo wearing ballerina slippers, dancing around and waving a wand, and winning one for the Gippers.
Yeah, amazing.
That was not amazing at all. That was a really terrible song.
That was very troublesome. Yes.
Yeah, it was really. Anyway, you're watching Dave's Gone By. Let's get to, remember, we've got our Colorado limerick of the damned coming up. We've got our new wretched pun of destiny to do in the program as well. We've got Rabbi Saul talking to Keith Sherman, the press agent. We'll have a bit of an Inside Broadway segment too. But why don't we get to our weekly segment called Greeley Crimes and Old Times. And this has to do with... Oh, I didn't bring my folder in, but...
I'll get it.
It's all right.
Sure.
It's Greeley Crimes and Old Times, which has to do with columns that appear in the newspaper where Joyce and I lived for a few years, Greeley, Colorado.
Jerse. My friend's Jerse. Father was Irish, so he was Irish, and he loved my name because he thought I was Irish, which I'm not. He'd say, Jerse, come up and play with the Kathleen, come on, Jerse. Peter and Kathleen are up there. Let's go play.
So Greeley Crimes and Old Times has to do with one column where it's phone calls that come into the Greeley Police Department, and the other of stories that appeared in the Greeley newspapers 100 years ago. And we mash them up in this segment because they're all, I mean, the newspaper particularly and intentfully chooses ones that are weird or goofy or funny or nostalgic. We, as I said, mix them up and put them in a segment that we like to call Greeley Crimes and Old Times. La da da do, la ba da dee, from the old indeed we. By the way, it's my telephone. Oh, it's by you.
Oh,
so
shit.
At 10:30, at 10:30, we'll check for
okay.
It. Maybe put it on buzz or something. Or
should I? I don't know how to do your phone. I'll put the volume on.
Yeah, because at 10:30 we've got Keith Sherman coming up, but before then it's time for Greeley Crimes and Old Times. So I'm gonna read just a few of these. For example, a crime is that happened a week or so ago. Police responded. Let me see if we have some of our noises here. Which is the siren thing?
Give me the one on the other side. Can you grab it?
Okay.
I got it. Here we go.
Police responded to a supermarket on 23rd Avenue for a very drunk man standing by a vending machine outside the supermarket with his pants down to his ankles.
Uh-oh, I don't like
they're doing some very interesting COVID tests, I've got to tell you.
Hold on.
Yeah.
You know what he said?
What's that?
Tell me too.
All I know is it's the first time a customer ever tried to get a ding dong into a machine, if you know what I'm saying. And I
That's
think you do.
disgusting.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Let's do a couple of old time ones as well. One day, a city cousin came to the farm. She saw the windmill and said, "Oh, see how good the farmers are to the pigs. They have electric fans to keep them cool." Ah, ah, ah. Come on, that needs a ba-dum-bum. This was printed in the newspaper 100 years ago. Yeah, that's appropriate.
The
Yeah.
pigs are happy.
Oh, there's the piggies. I get it. Yeah.
Yeah, they're happy pigs.
And by the way, in news from Cornish, Colorado, which I don't know
Cornish.
if it still exists,
Where's Cornish?
I don't know. I guess they have a lot of hen parties there. In news from Cornish, Mr. Carlson of Fauston came to town and bought Emery's, blah, 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 blah. He bought Mrs. Emery Thomas's pigs for a good price. So I guess he's not so good to the pigs at this point. He's selling them
Well,
in.
you know what? They're good until you cook them and eat them, right?
I know.
That's horrible.
Speaking of animals, dog owners. Dog owners need to
Oh, wait,
know
wait, wait, wait,
what.
wait,
Oh,
wait.
woof. Do we have a woof thing? Close. Oh, I guess cats hate dogs, so there you go.
Oh my God.
Dog owners need to
That's a bit
know
much, honey.
that the
Sorry.
city dog tax is coming due. If you don't pay the tax and you do not have a tag on your dogs, what do you think could happen?
I
This is
think
what they put in the
they're probably
newspaper.
gonna shoot them.
It could be taken by the city dog catcher, shot,
Oh, Lordy.
and left in the city dump.
There you go.
And that was a message from the
In the Wild
Greeley.
Wild West.
That
The
was
Wild
a
Wild West.
message from the Greeley Inhumane Society, by the way. Yeah.
Amen.
Oh, here's an advertisement.
That's
Advertisement time.
crazy.
Yes, sir. The young fellows are taken right up with the friendly velvet tobacco.
Ooh, that's the wacky tobacco, huh?
Just a dime and a nickel buys you enough pipe tobacco for a week
Just
of
a dime and a
smoking.
nickel?
Back in the day,
I
right?
think that's called 15 cents. I'm not
And
100%.
that was some good money back then. It was probably close to a buck in
Yeah. Oh,
our
yeah.
current money,
That's
right?
good money.
Well, anyway. Oh, did you know that they now have telephones in every room at the Drexel Hotel?
Whoa.
Whether the room
We're
has a
living it.
bath or not.
We're living a high life, buddy.
Rates starting at a dollar and up. But whether the room has a bath or, I mean,
No, most of the, so years ago when you had
yeah.
a hotel, most of it was like, okay, so we were in Sweden at a hostel,
Yeah.
and this couple thought they paid for a hotel,
Oh.
and we were at a hostel. The difference is that in a hotel, you have your own bathroom.
In a
We had
hostel
our
room.
own bathroom in the hostel because we paid, mucho money. But most of the time, years ago in a hotel or boarding house, you didn't have your own
Yeah, you're
potty.
communal. There's still a
Yeah,
hotel.
I
There are
mean,
places like that in New
that's the
York. The
deal.
cheapest pod places, like, you use the bathroom down the hall
That's the
that four other
deal.
people are using, you know.
That's the deal.
And that's how COVID is spread. But you know,
No, that's how you do pee pee.
as a wait, as a matter of fact, this leads us to
Uh-oh.
something very important. Make sure, hon, I'm going to need you to find like a musical instrument to accompany me on a song.
I don't know where the
Well, they're over there. There's in that box. What are
No,
you
but
looking
they're
for? Or
the
we have a tambourine
It used to
somewhere.
be there, I don't know.
I had to move it. No, it's right here.
The
Did I put
tambourine?
it in?
Okay, I'll
Yes.
play it. I got it. Oh.
Did I see that? Oh, I thought I saw it. It looked like the tambourine, but it's not. Hey, ma
I
give me a
think
moment,
those are
folks.
your mother's files, honey.
I put it somewhere that I thought would be safe,
Yeah.
and of course, it's not safe at all. Oh well,
Yeah,
it seems
oh,
to be
watch the
gone.
dogs behind you.
Oh well.
I'll go get a maraca from the other room. Hold on.
Yeah, we're going to need a maraca
Okay.
or some sort
I
of
will.
a musical instrument for this, I do believe. Not sure if I can remember the whole melody on this. I'm back. Hello. So anyway, let me give you a story. So in Greeley Crimes and Old Times, we also make time to take one story that isn't from Greeley in northern Colorado. We always do one story that's from elsewhere of odd and fun and kind of ridiculous news. And what could be more appropriate than something corona related? And this is from the New York Post, of course, which gives us a story that, quote, coronavirus can spread through aerosol feces. I will repeat that. Coronavirus can spread through aerosol feces. Here's the story. Oh, the grogger's here. Okay, that'll... Nah, that's just gonna be too distracting.
Okay, hold on. I'll find something. Where did that thing go, buddy?
I don't know. I don't know where all the stuff went. I just tried to get everything out of the way.
Yeah.
Maybe you can just you know, gently whack something
this
against something
be,
else.
This is not here.
Yeah, well.
It shouldn't be here.
Don't worry about it. Just.
Yeah, but it's near my exercise stuff here.
Okay, we're good. I think we're good. Are we good? I think we're good. So, hold on one moment.
No.
Because I want to do this right.
I can get something on my phone. Let's see.
Oh!
There we go. Okay,
there we go.
Yes.
Okay, but not yet. I mean, I found, when going through our stuff, I found my tambourine from when I was, probably about, I probably had this
that
when
was
I was
last year.
45 years old. Yeah,
did
yeah.
You just get it last year?
My Disney opera. I never actually went to Disneyland until my 20s or 30s even.
I have it. I'll play it far away so you're not hearing. It's going to be too loud. Close.
Yeah, no, but I want to show people the back of my tambourine. David, and I spelled my own middle name wrong. That's
oh
what a retard
God.
I was when I was a child. I spelled my middle name wrong. That was my address. This is where we lived back on Ocean Parkway in Brooklyn, New York. What did I say? House number, zip code 11218. And we were in apartment D6. This is absolutely, and the borough was Brooklyn. So if somehow I lost this tambourine, which I apparently didn't after all these years, they wouldn't know exactly where to give it back to me. This is before they could do serial numbers on things. I made sure.
That's good.
Except by spelling my own name wrong.
That does limit the amount of like.
This is why I never liked my middle name. I never liked Neil. It was like Neil. So and I never knew how to spell it. Anyway, so this will be. Let's see how it. Yeah, from over there gently.
Yes, sir.
But let me tell the story first, and then the song goes with the story.
Okay.
This is from the New York Post. Closing the toilet lid is highly recommended amid the coronavirus outbreak. Researchers have found that the bug can spread through fecal matters escaping from the bowl during a flush. A study shows that the disease caused by coronavirus, which we already know can be spread via fecal oral transmission, which, by the way, really sucks ass. Can be transmitted via, quote, aerosolized feces.
Oh, Jesus.
That is when poop can be propelled into the air by what is called, quote, a toilet plume. When aerosols, sometimes containing infectious fecal matter, are caused by a flush. And, you know, I mean, this is absolutely true. We heard this years ago where everybody thought they were being so sanitary when in public restrooms they do those hand blowers instead of people rubbing their or drying their hands on paper towels and stuff. They put up these hand dryers in the bathrooms, and all they're doing is taking the bacteria in the air from pee and poo that people have done and just blowing it on everybody everywhere. is making like the droplets going everywhere. So here's the deal. Close the lid and then flush, warns a mechanical engineering professor from Purdue University. Apparently, allegedly, closing the lid can prevent 80% of the fecal particles from escaping into the air. Okay, so, in honor of this, and I don't know why I did this, everybody's been doing parody songs about Corona. You know, my Corona, even the guy from the Knack, who's still alive, did something of a, you know, acknowledge that everybody's doing my Corona. God, Corona. Well, I decided to go in a very different direction. So, instead of that, ladies and gentlemen, I've decided to do a song that is based on this idea of closing the toilet lid just after you've gone so that the stuff doesn't go into the air and spread everywhere. I've called the song Toilet Plume. I'm going to do it live on the show, but I'm going to need it to be like very, because if I can't, I won't get the melody. I won't be able to remember it. Because I know everybody knows the first part of the melody of the song, but it's the second part that I didn't know. And it goes through a minor key. And I tried doing it. I may try to, since everything on this episode has gone to hell anyway.
And David, your friend's
key. In 10 minutes, yeah. I'm going to try doing this on virtual piano. This is going to be an absolute disaster, folks. I may try and do it more a cappella, but let's see if this works. First of all, let's try a major chord. By the way, if you're on the tambourine, it's going to be an E.
Okay.
So let's see if that works. I'm going to try it real slow. And it's a waltz. So it's gently 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3. The song Toilet Plume. I don't know how I'm going to... Actually, I really don't know how I'm going to do this, so...
Just sing an a cappella.
Yeah, I might have to, but I'll give myself a bouncy E. It flies through the air with the greatest of ease, a big toilet plume of your tainted feces. When you squeeze a poopy from deep in your tush, it reaches the world when you flush. The dinner you ate in your kitchen last night is hanging around in the room. Whoever inhales will be swallowing down the doo-doo you left in your plume. It flies through the air like a great bird of prey, the morsels of stool that explode in your spray. I'll read that again. It flies through the air like a great bird of prey, the morsels of stool that explode in your spray. So when you make duty, just keep it well hid, and make sure you lower the lid. The droplets of dookie get aerosolized and easily passed to the lungs. If you leave your seat up, then please be advised that strangers are tasting your dungs. That fly through the air from an open latrine, dispersing the microbes of COVID-19. So kindly remember when you're making slop to reach down and lower the top. Thank you, darling. I have to say, the tambourine on that was perfect.
Thank you.
The singing wasn't perfect. I should have picked a much higher key.
But I liked it.
Yes, yes.
It was very W.C. Fields feces-based. Yeah, I liked it.
So kindly remember, when you're making slop, to reach down and lower the top. I'm so
there,
proud
there
of that.
Are very few songs about feces that go like that.
That are to that, yeah. I've written many songs about feces, as you well know.
That's a beautiful
That's my go-to song. Topic, if you noticed in my life.
I enjoyed it.
Anything involving poo.
I enjoyed that feces song immensely.
Thank you. I want to do it more. I want to do a version where I've actually got some accompaniment to maybe this week.
Yeah, you could
since I won't be working.
You could work on it. That could be part of your work tasks.
But that is my toilet plume song. That is the highlight of the show so far, which is just tells you just how tragic this episode is. But it's going to get a lot better.
Because
we've got our Inside Broadway segment coming up. We've also got our our Colorado Limerick of the Damned, our Today Yesterday quiz about April 4th, which today is.
4-4, honey, 4-4.
And our Wretched Pun of Destiny. It is 4-4-2-0. We're with our 740th episode of Dave's Gone By here in the Daverhood with me, Dave Lefkowitz, and my darling and wonderful wife, Joyce, and Keith Sherman, the press agent, will be joining us in about 5 minutes talking to Rabbi Saul Solomon. Is he already?
No, but the volume's on, Booby.
Oh, fantastic.
I believe so. I tried. I don't know your phone, baby.
Looking good. Very good. Very good. So, anyway. We've got a few more minutes to do Gridley Crimes and Old Times, but not before I thank the fine folks at Hewlett Minuteman Press who are being really cool during this crazy, crazy time. They're still open with limited hours. I think they're open 4 hours a day during the week because they're an essential service. They take packages to UPS. They have to mail things. They are considered some of the things that they do. The world could not work without some of the activities that Hewlett Minuteman Press performs. So we thank them so much. And even though there was not a hard copy issue of Performing Arts Insider this week, we use them to print that wonderful publication that I'll tell you about during Inside Broadway, and they are a sponsor of this program. So if you have copying, printing, binding to do, you know, they, even though they're on limited staff right now, and specifically concentrating on stuff that they, that kind of has to get done during this period, they also need the money. They also need the work. They've got to pay their workers. They've got to stay open, right? Yeah. They don't want to be a victim, an economic victim of COVID. So if you have stuff that you want done for your business, for your company, you know, call or visit, well, don't visit, call Hewlett Minuteman
Press. You can virtually visit. I'm sure you can talk with them on the chit-chat.
Exactly. They'll be happy, very happy to hear from you. They'll be very happy for business right now. 516-569-5577, area code 516-569-5577. And if you tell them Dave sent you, Dave being me, from Dave's Gone By, you get 10% off any job, big or small. So give them a call. 516-569-5577. Hewlett Minuteman Press. They are the copy kings. And I just want to make sure that I've got something to play while, oh good, okay. So let's finish up, pardon me, Greeley Crimes and Old Times before we bring Keith Sherman and Rabbi Saul into the neighborhood. Let's do another crime, shall we? A caller?
Oh, give me the phone. Oh,
I have my phone.
No,
he's calling my phone. Oh, I'm sorry, that phone. A caller at a park on 13th Avenue reported people. See, this has to be completely in context.
Yeah.
A caller called police because he saw people in the park playing volleyball.
That's crazy.
Now, that would be crazy any other time they would put that in. But, of course, during Corona time, that's why they called. Is that people shouldn't be doing that. I mean, I saw people a week ago at our local park playing basketball, which is the one sport that you should not be engaged. I mean, baseball isn't that bad. Baseball, you're all distant, you're far away. Football, you don't play. Rugby, you don't play. But basketball, you got people wearing,
you know,
T-shirts.
You know what bothered me? The men and women playing Greco-Roman wrestling. That was messy.
I wouldn't do that. I certainly would not. Drool wrestling is the worst.
Yeah.
Because that's what kids would do. Like, if you tag someone and you would drool on their face to, like, yeah, eat my drool. It's like,
really? That's what people did?
I didn't do it.
Who did that? Who did that?
People in my mind did that. Yeah. Mario Cuomo did that to Chris when they were wrestling.
I don't want to hear that.
Not Mario. Oh, God. Not Mario. You'll be a good son.
This is how I feed you.
That's
messy.
One more Greeley Crime and Old Time. Let's do it. Let's do police responded to a park on Glenmere Boulevard. Oh, this is really sad. For a dead goose floating in the pond.
Where that is.
Glenmere, yeah. The caller asked if the officer could push it farther out into the pond. Not doing that, grabbing it, burying it, bring it to the animal. No.
Oh, you know just, why?
Why?
Because the dogs will go in to chase it. They'll want to eat it. Right
so
now.
You know what the officer did?
What?
He did. He pushed the duck, the dead duck, into the pond.
Wow.
And by the way, in the death of the police do not. Say that there's any foul play. Thank you. I'm down with that joke. And in seemingly unrelated news, the next day, a caller on the west side of the same park reported seeing a goose with no legs. So this is the day after there's one dead goose.
How could you have a goose with no legs?
Well, they're tastier. I don't know. That's a goose with no legs.
So we used to live near that park. I saw one time a goose that had one, like, lame leg, you know, or things like that. They get injured. It's like everybody else. They're flying around. They get injured.
Well, but this one had no legs. And I'm thinking there's some kind of east side, west side goose gang that's happening.
You know, it could be.
Yeah. And then it's just like one side. You kill our goose? We get you, Mother Ducker.
No, I think it was
Mother Ducker. Get
that? They were mad because the cop. They're like, "You pushed our friend in the water. We're gonna take it out on you, buddy."
So
we're gonna take it out on you.
So everybody, duck. Okay, there's a little joke there. It's about 10:30 in the morning, Eastern Time, and you're watching the 740th edition of Dave's Gone By with me, Dave Lefkowitz, my darling wife Joyce, all our potato friends. Mm-hmm. And now we're waiting on Rabbi Saul Solomon, who's going to be talking to a press agent, a guy who represents Broadway shows. Now, there aren't any right now, But he's done tons of shows. Let me get the rabbi's notes ready.
Yeah,
for when, as a matter of fact, I need to take this call. And while this is happening, let's start Inside Broadway, because we're going to talk about Broadway. Inside Broadway, a look at theater on and off Broadway and beyond. Brought to you by Total Theater and Performing Arts Insider. Curtain going up. Yes, Inside Broadway we go, and we're going to do it in a special way with a real Broadway person, Keith Sherman, the press agent, and he will be talking to Rabbi Saul Solomon the Great momentarily. So let's play a little bit of Broadway music while we get the rabbi in the room.
It's the famous gay white way, where the night is bright as day. Ain't Broadway grand?
It's not just a thoroughfare, it's a tingle in the air. Ain't Broadway grand?
It's excitement, it's romance, it's all fun and song and dance. This wonderland, you can be a millionaire quicker here than anywhere. Ain't Broadway grand?
Oh, Broadway is grand indeed, my friends. Oh, this is your old pal, Rabbi Saul Solomon, founder and spiritual leader of Temple Sons of Bitches in Great Neck, New York. And I do love and I miss the theater. I miss going in with a bunch of middle-aged and older people who all have body odor, who are all just, you know, a few steps away from the grave, and they're catching two and a half hours of joy by talented people sharing genius and creativity with themselves and then going out into the night and doing other horrible things. But, oh, there's no Broadway right now. It's killing me. However, we're going to talk right now to a person who knows a whole lot more about Broadway than you and me and everybody watching combined. He has been a publicist, a press agent for Broadway shows since 1983. His first show was the Flying Karamazov Brothers, and since then he has worked on such productions as Leader of the Pack, Big River, A Christmas Story, and the recent rock musical Be More Chill. He's also done concerts with really famous singers, and now it's very difficult. It's difficult times for all of us. Not only is Broadway at the moment kind of in a Sleeping Beauty state, or what was it, Snow White, more Snow Whitey kind of a state, but he's trying to keep his business going, and he's dealing with COVID, which apparently he has. So ladies and gentlemen, won't you please welcome to the neighborhood the ailing but wonderful Keith Sherman. Shalom, Keith.
Good morning, Rabbi. Speaking with the rabbi on
Shabbat. That's right. So, Keith, are you a Yidlach? Are you one of the tribe?
I think I am.
This is why God saved you, and you didn't die last week. He's saving you for better things.
That could be. That's a good reason. Right?
There's probably. I'll bet there's another somewhere in a year or two. There'll be another Fiddler on the Roof production, and so he's saving you to work on that, or either that or the Rothschilds, one of the two. But
listen, I was very, very lucky. I had a mild case. So many people have it much worse than I with these breathing problems, and I basically had a terrible flu for 2 weeks.
Oh. How did you... Now, first of all, you were diagnosed with COVID. You don't think you just had a flu. You know you had COVID?
Well, my husband is the medical director for two nursing homes, and one day he came home, and I actually tested negative, but then a few days later, I had all the symptoms of the except the bad one. You know, I could breathe.
Breathing,
on,
yeah.
But the chills and the fever and the cough and the night sweats and it was as bad as it could be for, you know, 10 days or so. And then, thank goodness, I recovered.
So you figured? Did you get tested again, or you just figure you came down with COVID after you tested negative?
Get tested. Yeah, and my God, most people can't get tested once.
I know, believe me, yeah.
Fortunately, I just showed up to facilities without an appointment in a car, and they said, just go through.
Mm.
So, didn't matter. I mean, I was negative on a Wednesday, but Sunday I had all the symptoms. It was pretty awful.
I can imagine. So, and there was nothing to do. I mean, you, thank God you're married to a medical person. Yeah, and by the way, we're very excited about this because the producer, the creator of this program, Dave, is married to a gerontologist, someone who works with older people. So your husband and she would have a lot to talk
about. That's what he does. That's his job. He's the medical director for two nursing homes.
Wow.
And yeah. My goodness, right now there's just, well, we all know the need. We all know what's going on. It's as terrible as it could be right now.
Well, here's the deal. Does he come home and tell you so many people died today or are just, they're sick, but they're okay? How's his nursing home doing?
Actually, all of that. It's as terrible as one could imagine. You know, you're watching television or listening to the radio. These numbers are frightening. Personally, I had a friend. I didn't even know he was sick. And I got an email from his office saying he had passed away that day. And I got a text from a friend of mine. His 92-year-old grandfather passed away.
Well, wait a minute now. Come on, 92. Let's face it. A gust of wind could have also not.
Right. Okay. He may have lived his whole life, but still, I mean, this person's grandfather. And young people are not immune to this disease. I mean, it's, you know, it affects human beings.
And it affects of all different age groups. That's the weird part. They're still trying to figure out why 30-year-olds are dying, 80-year-olds are dying, you know, and some people get it and are just carriers and are completely asymptomatic, and other people like you have it for 2 weeks, but thank God you get over it and you don't get the worst of it. But was there any, yeah, sorry.
Right. But you know, we're so young in this whole process. This thing just emerged a few months ago. And while every country, it seems, on the face of the earth is researching, and they have their top scientists looking at the thing, there still isn't enough information. We're just right in the eye of the storm. And it's, you know, it's a terrible moment. It's unprecedented in our society.
Well, in a way it is. Yeah, sorry.
I'm an optimist. I'm an optimistic person. And as difficult as it is, you know, we've all, many of us have gone through things like 9/11, through the AIDS crisis, through hurricanes, blackouts. Mm-hmm. I remember as a boy, my grandparents telling me about handling polio.
And, wow.
And their friends dropping, like, what's happening today?
Oh, you're telling me. I mean, 3 weeks ago, I had a canker sore on my lip, and it was so painful. Oh, my God. And, you know, people want to tell me about being in Auschwitz and Dachau. They did not have this canker sore. I've got to tell you.
You know, God bless you. Humor that we're going to be able to get through this terrible moment in our lives.
Who's joking? It was painful as hell.
We need to laugh. Make us laugh.
I'm trying. God knows I'm trying, ladies and gentlemen. No, we're talking. No, but how are you feeling now? Are you completely, thank God willing, healthy at this point?
Well, yesterday I made a raspberry shortcake. So, ooh. I mean, I think that's a good sign.
It is. It is a good sign. But can anybody besides you eat it? Is it safe for, like, your husband to eat? That's not actually a joke. I'm wondering, is it?
There's nobody else here. You know, it's just, and the dog, but we don't give it to Murphy.
Aww. Oh, I would hope not. That's a mercy in itself. But your husband has stayed healthy, even though he's the one surrounded by old people dying.
Yeah. He's back to himself, and he started to go to work after nearly 3 weeks.
Because he was caring for you.
Working every day. I mean, his phone started at 7 in the morning, and it was going till 11 at night with nurses, with doctors, with Zoom meetings and conference calls. And, you know, it's a moment in our lives.
Well, let me ask, what is he doing to protect himself? Because I would like to mimic whatever his behaviors are where he's not catching it.
Well, at the moment, conventional wisdom, and we really don't know enough, says that if you've had it, you've got an immunity for the moment. But like the flu, it could mutate. So maybe next year, like every year we get a flu shot, which I don't understand the chemistry of it, but it's slightly different than the one that we've had in the previous year because the chemical composition of the biological composition of the virus changes. So this may happen, but for the moment, it seems to be somewhat uniform around the globe. But he's had it now. So
You didn't tell me he had it. I didn't realize he had caught it too.
Oh, well, it started with him. One of his patients and one of his facilities was sent to a hospital.
Oh.
And when he came back to the facility, he was positive. Then the Department of Health came in the next day, and six members of the staff also tested positive. I mean, it's a very contagious thing.
So were his symptoms as bad as yours? Was he laid up for 2 weeks and blah, blah, blah?
Yeah.
Oh.
He had it a little worse than I did. Mine was even mild. I mean, it just lasted longer. With him.
So let me, you know, as a married person, I've been married for many years to my darling and lovely wife, Miriam Libby. We have 27 and a half beautiful children who, thank God, are healthy at the moment. But who's the worst patient? Who's the more whiny? Who's the more kvetchy? You or your husband?
Me. I'm a terrible patient.
Oh, really?
I'm a terrible patient. Yeah. But, you know, we're together now.
Wait, how long? How long are you together? I missed that.
33/11 years. We were married on the day of our 22nd anniversary. So that's a good thing.
Okay, wow, that is... How did you meet your husband, by the way?
We met at the gym, at the Paris Health Club on the Upper West Side, back in the late 80s, 1986. Just working out one day after work.
And were your parents thrilled that you found a Jewish doctor to marry?
Oh my God, my mother got free blood thinning medicine.
If you have any spare, you know, I feel sometimes I wake up, I feel my blood is very thick. And you know, I'm very sludgy, I can barely get out of bed. I could use a little of that blood thinner, ladies and gentlemen. But you know, we've been talking so much about this damn disease. We have Keith Sherman on the phone who has been, you know, you've been married 33 years. How long ago did you start in the theater?
Oh my God, well, one of my college roommates grew up in New Rochelle, and his English teacher was the fellow that founded the Roundabout Theater. Today is this very important theater company with several Broadway theaters. But back in the late 70s, there were two theaters. One was under a supermarket on 26th Street between 8th and 9th, and the other theater on 23rd is now the School of Visual Arts Movie Theater. But back then, we were, you know, doing Shakespeare and Pirandello and Shaw, and we did a lot of dance. And I would basically rip tickets. I would go for coffee. I was an intern before they were called internships. Mm-hmm. And one day, the boss came up to me, and he said, what are you doing when you graduate college? I said, I guess I'll find a job. He said, how would you like to be our marketing director? I said, sure. Wow. So that was my first job when handling the Roundabout Theater Company. And it lasted for about a year until one day a printer, because I was the marketing guy, we owed $200 to this man, and the theater was broke and they hadn't paid him. Yeah. So I was walking into the theater one day and he beat me up in the lobby.
He
had blood dripping from my face.
What the? What? Oh my God.
Maybe I should find another job now.
Holy, he beat you. Did you, wait, stop right, did you press charges?
No, you know, I mean, I was just a kid. I was 20-something years old. So I said, I'm going to find a new job now. So that I lasted for a year at the Roundabout.
Wow.
Then
you owe Todd Haymes a punch in the nose, by the way. That was meant for him.
This is years before Todd was even involved.
Or was it Gene Feist? Who was the original guy there?
Oh, my God. Listen to you. You knew. Gene Feist and Michael Fried.
I didn't even remember that. But okay, yeah, so you should punch... And I think they're dead. So open their coffin and punch them in the nose because you owe them one, for God's sakes.
It's all right.
You let it go.
From that right now.
But so you...
Great.
Yeah.
I found a job with one of the theater's leading press agents. And I was his assistant. I was 22. And my first job was working on the Sherlock Holmes play called The Crucifer of Blood that Glenn Close was the star of with Paxton Whitehead.
Oh, I love Paxton Whitehead. He's what a fabulous... I mean, not that Glenn Close is nothing a Kaddish, but I'm saying, Paxton Whitehead, what a fabulous...
An amazing actor. So, and then we did a play with Rex Harrison and Claudette called Colbert.
All right, stop right there. Stop right there. If you are promoting a play that starred Rex Harrison, a world-renowned, apparently, asshole, you must have some stories. You must have some behavior stories about Rex Harrison. Go.
Well, this was, I was just a little assisted. But, you know, I didn't have that experience. But
oh.
In this particular production, he was with Claudette Colbert and George Rhodes.
Oh.
Three-hander. And apparently they all got on rather well.
Oh.
The show lasted for a season. It was called Aren't We All? I mean, three great leading men and women. I mean, three great stars of the theater.
Yeah.
Doing a cream puff of a play. I mean, it was a delicious experience.
Oh.
I got to hang out with all of them, and I started to learn my craft.
Well, what was, how is it different? Like, you had to publicize, you had to promote a play back in 1983, let's say, that Aren't We All was. Different back then from the way you promote and publicize a play today?
Oh, very different. The whole media landscape has shifted. I mean, quite substantially. Something called social media has presented itself.
Never heard of it. Yeah. No, but let's say, what would be a typical day back in the mid-early 1980s of publicizing this big play with these great stars? If you didn't have so, how would you do it?
Oh, my God. Well, my job, I was typing press lists on carbon paper.
Wow.
I mean, that was my gig. How glamorous is that?
Well, I like carbon paper. Yeah.
And I had to run to stage doors and drop memos off with stage doormen for the stars, setting up their interviews for the next day.
Yeah, I guarantee you, if Moses and God had carbon paper back in the day, there would have been more than one set of tablets of the Ten Commandments. They would have kept a spare elsewhere, just in case. You know, it's like he's carrying these Ten Commandments, but in a drawer somewhere, he's got the carbon copy, to, you know, in case people forget number 9 or something. Everybody forgets
Listen,
number 9.
I have a feeling most of your listeners don't even know what the hell carbon paper is.
No, most of my they know what carbon paper is.
But maybe some of them do, you know.
My listeners remember mimeograph machines, for God's sakes.
Okay. It's before cell phones, people.
Yeah.
You know, it's before cell phones.
So when you would type up a press listing, so these were the people, a press list are the critics and the other media people that you would invite to see a show, to review it, to talk about it, to do preview pieces on these productions. Am I correct?
Absolutely right. Absolutely right. But I was the kid in the office. You know, I did all the grunt work.
Okay.
You know, I answered the phone and, you know, whatever needed to get done.
Well, this is important. This is how you learn. This is, you have to be the newbie.
How you learn.
Yeah.
But if you're smart, you act like a sponge and you absorb what's going on around you. And I was blessed with working with some very senior people who were very experienced and very well respected, and I learned. You know, I kept my mouth shut and my ears open.
Well, what are the kinds of things that you didn't know in your first week or month working there that you kind of learned a year or two or three into the business? Something that you didn't expect, or something that, oh, this makes a lot of sense.
You know, that's a great question.
Thank you.
But it goes beyond any element of business. It's about life. You learn how to handle people, you know, because you're working with some very fancy people, people who, you know, have healthy egos, people who are great artists or great businessmen and women. And, you know, you learn how to handle them, how can move things along, how the world works on a more complex level than having grown up in New Jersey with my father running a furniture store and my grandparents running bakeries.
Ooh.
You know, you're dealing with fancy people. And that appealed to me. I found that incredibly exciting because I fell in love with the theater at a very, very early age.
All right, then that leads to the question, what is the first show that made a big, either that you first went to or made a big impression on you at the theater that changed your life?
Yeah. I have that nailed. It was 1776. I was 14. I saw it from the last row of the balcony. That was playing at the 46th Street Theater, which is where Hamilton is playing today. And I have a very clear memory of that show. If you know it, the last moment, a scrim comes down, and the light Independence, which has been sung about now for 2 hours. And this 14-year-old kid just had this jolt of electricity shoot through his entire body. I started shaking and sweating during the curtain call.
You had COVID.
And I sat down and I was exhausted. I said, what the hell is that? And how do I feel it again?
And how did you feel it again? What was the next show that gave you that same kind of feeling?
Oh, my God. Remember seeing Butterflies Are Free with my high school English class. So I grew up in Jersey, and I was the kind of a kid where the bus to New York, which was 45 minutes from the town I grew up in, stopped in front of my high school. I would cut classes on a Wednesday afternoon, jump on the bus, buy a standing room ticket to a show, and then be home before my family knew what I had done. I saw hair that way.
Wow. Wow. And you saw all kinds of hairs all over their naked bodies. I'm sure they were thrilled to to know that, if you think about it.
Absolutely right.
And let me ask you, when you bought a standing room only a ticket to shows like Hair in the late 60s, early 70s, was that ticket like $1.50?
It set me back $8, I remember.
Oh, really? $8? That actually sounds pretty hefty for that time. Doesn't it?
Maybe I'm making that up. I don't know.
Yeah, because TEF was charging maybe 12 in the 80s.
Your outrageous prices. So one of the shows I handled was The King and I during Yul Brynner's last Broadway run.
Yeah.
This was in the early 80s. It was at the Broadway Theater. And for his final performance on Broadway in The King and I, we charged the ungodly price of $75.
Well, you know, that was ungodly back. I mean, we laugh about it now, but that was a lot of money back then. That is an equivalent of about $300 for a ticket now. So it was, you know, even...
I have a memory.
Yeah.
You know, in the 70s, Liza Minnelli in the act, $25 for an orchestra ticket. Can you believe it?
I believe. But here's one of the things. Again, we've got to go... One of the nice things about doing this program and being nostalgic about things is that we can say both nice things and speak ill of the dead. So do you have any nice or not nice stories about Yul Brynner?
I only want to talk positive. The one of the quirks about Mr. Brynner was that before we were working with him on tour, and before he would move into a city, before he would go into a dressing room, it had to be painted dark brown. That was his color. So we had to mobilize forces, and his personal space had to be painted before he arrived in the city dark brown. I have another memory when we were on Broadway. The Queen of Thailand came to visit, and of course the King and I are set in Thailand, and that became a big deal. Making all those arrangements and the entourages and the pomp and circumstance. It was fantastic.
I thought you were going to say it was just a pain in the butt and not worth the time and effort to do it, but you're saying it was kind of great to do.
No, it was great. I mean, The Queen of Thailand. It was a show about Thailand.
Now, speaking of personalities, and again, maybe you'll just have positive and happy stories about this, but at one point, did you represent a concert or something by Frank Sinatra?
Yes. Years ago, I worked for Radio City Music Hall. And subsequently, I worked for one of the giants in the PR world, a fellow named Lee Salters. And Sinatra was a client of the office. For many, many years, Lee represented Sinatra.
Any stories, good or bad?
Oh, my God, Frank Sinatra stories. Well, that's not an account that I was working on, but they shielded us from a lot. But, you know, I Frank Sinatra stories. I can't be of help to you there right now.
Okay.
No.
All right. Okay. What about, I can go to some other people.
I did recently. Yeah. Here's an amusing thing.
Yeah.
You know, his wife Barbara died, and I ended up buying a painting that they bought and had in their home from the early 40s. It was a picture of a movie set, and he's in the painting, and he starred in the film.
Whoa.
So that's a new addition to my life, and I'm really, you know, it sort of comes full circle a little bit. I'm really happy that, you know, that happened. And, you know, I kind of adored this painting, the history of it, and the fact that, you know, just what it represents. By a guy named Richard Worf, who was the director of the film that took place in 1945.
Wow, that's pretty. So really, it's gratitude to his widow for dying. That this.
You have a twisted mind, don't
who,
you?
Who, me? Oh, not at all. Speaking of strange and difficult times, you had mentioned before that you, as a person and also as a working person in the entertainment field, even before COVID, you dealt with AIDS and also 9/11, particularly for Broadway 9/11. What was it like then? How did Broadway climb out of this idea that who's going to want to sit in the middle of Manhattan, 5 miles from, you know, ground zero bombing, and come back and do Broadway shows and see Broadway shows? How did you help pull people back into the Broadway world?
That post 9/11 was kind of a wonderful moment, I think, in the lives of so many New Yorkers. Broadway closed down for two performances,
right.
I remember. And then there was this event that took place in Times Square that was organized by the Broadway League. And we pulled together everyone that was in a show, all these great New Yorkers, and everyone got together in Duffy Square before the Red Steps, just saying, come to New York, see a Broadway show. We're open for business. Come. Join us, go to a restaurant, go to a show. And it was a huge success. And that was one of the catalysts that started New York back on the trail of, you know, after that horrible moment in our world.
And I think also it helped that the producers was running at that point, and people would pay $100, not $75, but $150 to the producers were like, you know what? If it were any other show, I'd probably cancel, I'd stay home, I wouldn't go, I'm scared. But for the producers and Nathan Lane and Matt Brock, you know what, I think I'll go, you know. And
absolutely right.
Yeah.
That was the Hamilton of its time. And, it was a huge cause celeb, and that became a giant magnet to help bring people back to the theater. Absolutely right.
Do you think Hamilton will be able to do that, let's say, in June-ish?
Wouldn't that be great? I think, you know, Hamilton will be one of many shows that, you know, theater people have strong spirits, and we will band together, and we will come up with plans and events and reasons to bring people back to New York, to bring people back into the theaters once it's safe to do that.
I'm thinking live sex acts, because that will really be the only thing that would get me there for a while. I've
been there, done that, no?
Well, we've been there, done that, but I could do it again, and certainly watch at my age. That would be, you know, live sex acts back on 42nd Street, 8th Avenue. It could be 8th Avenue, it could be 7th Avenue. Either, even 52nd Street, I'd go that high. Oh my, are you about to tell us an old Calcutta story? That was simulated. That wasn't, Dave, who hosts this program, saw old Calcutta.
Sorry to disappoint you.
Wait a minute. You mean old Calcutta had actual... Dave doesn't remember that.
Come on, Rabbi, get with the program.
I guess. I'm beyond my own program at this point. But let me... You are a member of ATPAM, right? The Association of Theatrical Press Agents. And
I am. And I'm also a member of the Film Publicity Union. I'm in two PR unions.
Oh, I didn't know that. But as speaking in terms of the theater press agent stuff, you will probably get a little more of the skivvy from the Broadway League and the American Theater Wing. Right now, they're still supposedly saying that Broadway theaters are closed until April 12th. And... they're going to reopen April 13th. There's no, they're not. But they're not wanting to choose a date yet that things will reopen. What's the latest thing you've heard?
Well, you know, first of all, I think on a national level, it's already been talked about through the end of April. But I think it's going to be extended. You know, the Tonys have been postponed.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
All the major award shows for the spring have been postponed.
Well, there goes my Obie. Yeah.
Don't know, but it's looking like late spring, hopefully, maybe, I don't know, into the summer. We just don't know. I mean, we need to get past this terrible our lives. I mean, the uncertainty of it is very difficult. But one thing that's really interesting is that it's not just about me or you. It's really about us. It's just...
No, it's about me. Everything is about me.
It's showing how connected we really are with each other. Yeah.
Except we can't be connected with each other. The only way you connect is by video at the moment. That's
the. Isn't that kind of fascinating?
Well, people have said that we're very lucky that this isn't 1960, because there would have been, you know, all there would have been was four channels on the television set, no internet, no audiobooks, no Netflix, no Hulu, no nothing. You just kind of you have to sit there and read all day, which.
Research. Now, this is before my time,
okay.
But in 1609, something called the bubonic plague
yes.
swept the world. And in England, the Globe Theatre, which a guy named Shakespeare was running,
never heard,
had King Lear on its stage. And they had to cancel performances of King Lear and close the theatre until the plague was over. So if you go back, what's that, 400 plus years? History repeats itself.
It does. Yeah, no, I mean, yeah.
You know, it's different, of course. This is unprecedented in our life and our society. But, you know, things like 9/11 and things like blackouts and hurricanes have postponed the theater, postponed our lives, but not to the magnitude that we're feeling right now. But, yeah, thank God for all these streaming services and the ability for us to stay at home and still be entertained. You know, there's something like called Broadway HD, where you can see Broadway shows and off-Broadway shows in their entirety from your living room.
That's right. And the Royal National Theatre. And I cannot tell you how many high school productions of plays and musicals are on YouTube. Well, you can just pick any show, and you will see either entire productions of them taken with one camera by a parent very far away, you know, with the hand shaking, but still you get an idea. Oh, there's Molly Brown up there. That's her. Yeah. I mean, there's stuff that you can certainly entertain yourself with for hours and hours on end. And we're very, in that way, in an isolated way, we're quite, thank God, we're very lucky. Speaking of,
you know, there's also something really interesting that God created years ago called a book.
And I'm a we're people of the book. And then I'm tired of books.
You can actually pick up a book and sit down in a chair and read.
I know.
You know, what a blessing is that?
It's we have the time to do that. That's one of the things that we've forgotten about, is that suddenly when your day is open to you, you're not working 8 hours and getting on the subway and schlepping here and going there. It's like, oh, I have an hour where I can just read something. I choose the Torah.
Clean your house up. Organize your life a little bit. Get rid of some of the clutter and the crap.
Well, actually, here is one of the things. This is a cool question. Since you've worked on so many shows for all these years now, what are some of your favorite pieces of memorabilia that you've been able to accumulate in shows that you've represented or shows you've seen or gifts from, you know, producers or cast members or something like that? What are things you would never throw out?
One of my dearest friends in the world was a guy named Miles White. Miles was a costume designer, and he designed the original production of Oklahoma and Carousel. Oh. He was the first designer to put a sequin on an elephant working for the circus. And I had lived with one of his Tony Awards from a 1955 musical called Bless You Are. Bless Us All, rather.
Okay.
And I lived with some of the costume sketches from Bye Bye Birdie.
Whoa.
Which on the back have the actual gold lame samples from Conrad Birdie's costume.
Whoa.
So that's pretty cool. I have a drawing he did of Ethel Merman in a film called There's No Business Like Show Business.
So let me ask you, do you have enough of this kind of stuff where, now God willing, Keith, you will live another 30, 40 years or more, and then you won't get COVID again, you won't get anything again, you'll be very healthy, but are you making provisions, like when you and your husband go, that this will go to the New York Public Library of Performing Arts or the Lawrence and Lee Institute, you know, where they can keep this stuff that has historical significance?
Actually, the answer to that is yes and no. I operate a second business. I operate an art gallery because we have been collecting American modern art for the 3 decades we're together, and we have too much. So we're actually selling some of it. But every year we give works away to different museums because we think it's important to give back. So, yeah, I mean, so some of it, because my belief is that we don't really own this material. We live with it for a while, we kind of rent it. It will outlive us, but we pass it on, you know. We live with it for a while, and then we let it go.
I like that. That's a lovely attitude about you're just sharing it for the moment. You're enjoying it, and then whoop, it's meant to be to everyone.
Yeah, it's going to outlive all of us. So some of it we'll give away, some of it we'll sell, so we can acquire more and live with it for a while, and then pass that on, and it just sort of keeps going. For many years, I represented Al Hirschfeld.
Oh, the cartoonist, the drawer guy.
For the last 15 years of his life.
Yeah.
And I've represented his foundation since he passed away. And, I mean, there's an artist that, you know, captured the heart of the 20th century across the board for popular culture, mostly for the theater, but film and television and music and politicians and literary figures. He was just an amazing human being.
Huh. Do you have any Al Hirschfeld stories?
I remember sitting with him once. Yeah, I mean, I would sit with him in his, he lived on 95th Street between Lex and Park, and his studio was on the top floor of this pink townhouse. And, you know, he would do interviews, and the world media giants would come and talk to him. He would, you know, some of the things that came out of his mouth were just astonishing because he knew everyone. But he would say, if you live long enough, everything happens. And that was often when he was given some kind of an award or an accolade that sort of came out of left field. He just said, well, I'm living long enough, you know, so.
Every time you live long enough, everything
stories
happens.
Stories about people, you know, just.
Well, who are some of the we're talking with Keith Sherman, the longtime publicist and veteran press agent. Who are some of the favorite people or shows that you have represented? Like your most golden moments doing the job that you do.
You know, I'm a guy that lives in the moment. So my favorite show is the one I'm working on today.
Which is?
Nothing.
Well, I know that. A month ago, what show were you working on?
I've got no clients right now. Yeah. They're all, you know, everything's either canceled or postponed or, you know, it's irrelevant. But we're all hopeful it's going to come back later in the spring or in the summer. But, you know, I'm just going to be optimistic.
Right,
but,
yeah.
You know, that things that I don't know about will present themselves. And, you know, I work with many great men and women producers who have a dream and a dollar. And, you know, we get their shows on their feet. And, you know, we'll be bringing audiences to see them and we'll be entertaining.
God willing. No,
we're going to want great entertainment. You know, people, we're going to want to make and need to make people smile and to forget about the horrors that we're living through right now.
God willing. But you know, we want to smile from your experiences in the past. So either what is a show of all the shows you've represented that you?
There are so many. I mean, for example, I worked on the original production of 42nd Street under David Merritt.
I didn't know that. Okay, here we go. Okay, yeah.
That was an amazing experience. And just, you know, the various publicity stunts. This was after Mr. Merrick. I worked on it beginning in the second or the third year after he had his stroke.
Oh.
But, you know, his wife was involved. But still, he was very much involved in, you know, handling 18 years of Tony Awards was also kind of.
All right, well, Keith, let me stop you right there. Keith, let me, handling 18 years of Tony Awards. Tell people behind the scenes, like, you know, everybody watches it on TV from Radio City or they used to see it from theaters. What goes on? behind the scenes at the Tony Awards, and how are you involved?
Well, my job was managing the public profile of the Tonys, and I coordinated. I worked for the at the end the Broadway League and the American Theater Wing, which ran the Tony Awards, and I coordinated with all of the press offices for the Broadway productions and the television network, and journalists from around the world who were interested in the theater, who wanted to report on Broadway's best and, you know, the greatest theater award extant. So there's as you can imagine, there's a lot of politics. You know, in any given year, there's about three dozen-ish productions that are eligible, and that gets whittled down to nominees and dealing with producers and directors and writers and actors and designers and coordinating with various offices and the television component and running a lot of different events.
Well, the night of the Tony Award night, I mean, that you don't have the journalists sitting in the audience with all the actors and the nominees. Where are they and how are they coordinated and all that?
Tony Award night usually started at about 8 in the morning, where we would have the first of two dress rehearsals for the Tony Award. Normally, many of the shows would play matinees that day. Some of them didn't, but some of them did. So in order to rehearse their production number for the cameras, we did a rehearsal early in the morning at around 9 and then one in the mid-afternoon. So the shows that played matinees, the cast would come in early and run their number for the cameras.
Wow.
And then at 3 o'clock we would have another rehearsal for shows that weren't playing matinees. You know, we had there was always special material, say an opening number.
Right.
Presenters would come in and run their short bits. The ladies would hold up oftentimes their dress, so the lighting designers can get
How high would they hold up the dress? Now that I'd like to see. Yeah, okay.
Well, for color and just, you know, some of them did, some of them didn't. You know, every situation was unique. People would come in from around the world to present awards. You know, a lot of local people, but, you know, I remember a year that Audrey Hepburn came in. That was a big deal for us. You know, it was a who's who of the entertainment business, because many movie stars had gotten their start in the theater. And
oftentimes,
as you know, people would come back to simply to show up to present an award. It was an exciting but wildly challenging time managing the, you know, people's expectations and the demands and, you know, walking a tightrope often, just keeping everything going forward.
And
I had a great time.
Yeah. Well, were you sad when, because there's a different agency handling the Tonys now, were you sad or was it time to let that go when they changed?
I handled it for 18 years, which is a pretty long run for anything in life, particularly in the entertainment business. But everyone I started with either died or retired. And the new people that came in wanted different people. So that's, you know, I mean, I've been around long enough. That's the way it works, you know. But I had a great run. I loved it. I was sad when it happened. I've come, you know, it's years now.
Right.
In the meantime, I've been handling the Drama Desk Awards. I've been handling the Cheetah Rivera Awards. So it's just life shift. It's okay. I'm a happy person.
There's that optimistic tone again. And it has been a wonderful run talking with you on this program on Dave's Gone By. So here's the deal. In terms of thinking optimistically for the future, if you're thinking in terms of summer and fall, what shows are we expecting you to work on, assuming they don't get canceled? well, you know.
My goodness.
Yeah.
The truth is, I have no idea. You know, there are shows that I'm not even aware of that, God willing, will be hiring us. And some of the things that we had in the pipeline, I mean, I don't know. Right now, I'm not on any. I was not on anything currently running on Broadway.
Okay.
Hopefully, that will change. It may or may not. But there'll be things that come in. I mean, I work in film and music and dance and fine art and television. Things will present themselves.
So
I just don't know what they're going to be.
Well, I'm sure. God, I mean, no, I'm not. I can't be sure. Nobody can be sure right now. But God willing, things will work out. You will have more shows than you know what to do with, or at the very least, you can volunteer to represent this podcast here. We could certainly use the help. God knows, can't really pay you. We can pay you in matzah if that works for you. Let me ask you a quick question.
How about lox, eggs, and onions?
Even better. I don't know. We can't afford lox, but onions we can afford. We'll talk. But how Jewish are you? I mean, you know, we mentioned you are Jewish. You married a Jewish doctor. But do you celebrate anything? Will you have, if this were an ordinary year, would you be celebrating Pesach in a week or what?
Yeah, with my family, absolutely. We do Passover every year. But I'm a cultural Jew. I'm really in it for the food.
So let me ask, I ask this of everybody, even if they're not Jewish. What is your Hebrew name? Because Keith, I don't know where the hell they get. What was it?
Tuppel?
Tuppel?
I was named after my father's father. Who came in from the old country, who came in from Russia in the early, you know, the 1910s, teens.
Well, let me just say, on behalf of the Dave's Gone By audience and for my Temple Sons of Bitches, that Keith Sherman, you make a lovely couple, if you know what I'm saying. That's Jewish joke there. It has been delightful having you on the program. I do wish you, by the way, more than anything else, continued health and your husband too, because apparently people don't get it over again. It doesn't come back. And you know,
God willing, right?
And he's a Jewish doctor, so he will help you no matter what. But it's been lovely talking with you. Health, and then followed by continued success. And we thank you,
Rabbi, and thank you, David. Much appreciated. As they said on Star Trek, live long and prosper.
Halabai, we should all. And bless you from me, bless you if you sneeze, and shalom to you, couple. Bye-bye now.
A blessing on your head, mazel tov.
Mazel tov. Bye-bye now.
Take care.
Oh, we had Keith Sherman on the program. Couple Sherman, ladies and gentlemen. The press person, I wish I could tell you, now go see this show that he's working on, but fast forward a couple of months, and I bet you will. So, anyway, thank you so much. Now we're going to bring Dave back in to continue the program, because he's got so much to do. There's so much more on this Dave's Gone By that started out so crappily. I was listening, but it's getting better and better, isn't it? So, let's hear that damn Broadway song one more time while I bring Dave back in. Or I try to. Oh, here we go.
Where the night is bright as day, ain't Broadway grand.
It's not just a thoroughfare, it's a tingle in the air.
Tingle, tingle.
Ain't Broadway grand.
Yeah.
It's excitement, it's romance,
woo-hoo.
It's all fun and song and dance. This wonderland.
Sing it, baby.
You can be a millionaire. Here than anywhere. Ain't Broadway grand.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, thank you. Thank you so much for bearing with us with all the technical difficulties we had early in the show and for joining us on this platform for Dave's Gone By, at least for this week while Facebook gets its act together. But thank you for everybody who moved and migrated from the Dave's Gone By page to this one for this week, the Miracle of Long John's page. And that includes my friend Robert from high school. I'm sorry, Robert. He had a question for the rabbi, but the rabbi was in the midst of chatting with, he says, if on Passover next week, I decide to have a pepperoni pizza while self-isolating at home, will I evoke God's wrath in the form of, say, a plague?
It's not leavened. It's not leavened. They tell him make it out of matzah.
If you make your pepperoni pizza out of matzah and you add extra ham, I think God will look the other way.
No, the pepperoni should be brisket.
You know,
they could be, the pepperoni could be
could you imagine a brisket
salami.
Pizza?
My good. For meat eaters, I don't eat it.
You know, I'm wondering, because you can put cheese on roast beef. So a roast beef pizza. Roastitza. I don't know. I'll ask the rabbi, and maybe we'll have an answer for you next week. And by the way, Montana Tony says shalom. Hello, Montana Tony, and thank you for
Montana Tony.
yeah,
Ooh.
well, that's cool.
That's a nice name.
Yeah, it's better than North
Montana
Dakota
Tony.
Sal. Yeah, right. Anyway,
It's
we're
like Red Hook Phillip.
I know. But anyway, and then remember that if you missed the show, it started late. We started the show about 15, 20 minutes late because we couldn't be on our other Facebook page.
We had issues.
But or you have people who normally tune in and you know they would enjoy the show or they would love Keith Sherman and the Rabbi, or they missed our amazing song about the toilet plume. Remember that we do archive and save these programs. You can find them all at davesgoneby.com. DAVESGONE. Davesgoneby.com. It will take us a day to post this latest episode on that website. But we've got our shows going all the way back to the very first one in October of 2002. And I've spent, and one of the nice things about being off from my day job the last 3 weeks has been that I could go and go through the archives and fix dead links and things like that. So I know that the first 7 years.
Help.
Oh,
Help.
are you okay? Hold on one moment, please.
Help.
Hold on. Oh.
Thank you. I
So,
had an issue, sorry, I couldn't get
my
out.
wife was trying to help our dog. But can you hand that to me, please? The
I'll
thing came
plug
off
you in. Yeah, I
the
got you.
computer. Thank you.
No, I don't know where you're going.
So, what was I saying? Oh, the website, davesgoneby.com. So, I know I've been going through the links of the older shows, and we're good from like 2002 through mid 2009 now. They're all been rejiggered, and they work much better, and they got the photos up, and it's fantastic. And the last couple of years as well, it's a little hinky in the middle years, but stay with it. And tons of interviews, tons of wonderful shows that we have been doing here since October of 2002. That's why this is our 740th episode of the show. We're here live on April 4th, 2020. We've been calling this episode Sherman's April, as opposed to Sherman's March. Get it? Let's see. And what else? We still have our Colorado Limerick of the Damned to do. We're going to go inside Broadway rather briefly, and we will have our wretched pun of destiny. So much fun ahead. Do not go anywhere. You're not going to want to go anywhere. You're going to be right here watching this show. And by the way, if you want to get in touch with me, davesgoneby@AOL.com is the place to go. davesgoneby@AOL.com. If you want to know more about the rabbi, if you find him fun and funny, as Keith Sherman apparently did, then go to the rabbi's website, shalomdammit.com. And that is a place where you can watch his stage show, shalomdammit.com. And also the 10 episodes of a very funny program that he did on Long Island Cable TV about 10 years ago. It's all there, shalomdammit.com, and his Twitter feed at Rabbi Sol Solomon. Solomon. Sol Solomon. Okay, I think that's enough of plugs and promotions. Let's get on to more of the show since we're still in a, oh, my hair, it's still in a Broadway mode. Let's do some inside Broadway more stuff again. I mean, technically, we've been talking Broadway this whole time. So let's do some Broadway news. Basically, there's certainly no Broadway reviews or off-Broadway or regional theater news or reviews to bring you these days. You can, as Keith Sherman told the rabbi, see a bunch of theater things all across the internet now. You've got Broadway folks who are isolated at home. They're supposed to be in shows opening on Broadway as we speak. They can't be. And yet they're putting up videos of singing songs from the shows. The cabaret people are singing at pianos and doing short videos of songs you might like to hear. The Royal National Theatre of England, they're putting up a different production that they have done in their archives over the years. And I think this year they're doing, or this week, they're showing One Man, Two Governors, the show that really rocketed James Corden to prominence in America. He was already kind of famous in England, and that made him a star, and now he's a late night host. So that, and he's hilarious in the show. The Royal National Theatre is making that production available online to everyone for the next week for free. These are free things. Broadway at HD, you do have to pay for. Maybe they're offering a few free week of programming, and this is a website that has dozens
Oh.
of Broadway and foreign shows that you can just watch if you miss the theater or you remember a show that you liked and they have a recording of it. You can go watch it from the comfort of your room. They've got that available. There's all sorts of places that you can watch and enjoy theater during this crazy, crazy time. That, as Rabbi Saul and Keith Sherman agreed, Broadway is still, if you go to all these websites of shows that were running on Broadway a couple of weeks ago, everything from Phantom of the Opera and Chicago and Wicked to shows that were about to open, like Diana, the musical, or Six, the musical, or The Minutes, the new play by Tracy Letts, or the revival of Who's Afraid of Virginia Woolf. All these things, well, that's actually going to close, but or never going to open. But a lot of shows that were running for a while, Ain't Too Proud, Tina, the Tina Turner musical, To Kill a Mockingbird, these shows that were playing in early March. As I was telling 2 weeks ago, I went to see Girl from the North Country on Tuesday, and Broadway was shut down 4 days later, right? So it was like that. These productions are still technically on hiatus until April 13th. That's been the standing thing of when they're supposed to reopen. They're not reopening on the 13th. I'm telling you that right. Nothing's reopening on April 13th. And I think for now, Governor Cuomo can say April 20th for certain aspects. They're not going to reopen giant 1,200, 1,400 seat Broadway theaters to masses of people in the middle of April. That ain't going to happen either. They're just reticent to mention an actual date for the comeback and then have to go back on that again. And start making plans based on, oh, okay, May 14th. Then, we'll get the people to start rehearsing again backstage, and we'll get the carpenters going and the unions and so forth, and then have to have that pushed back. So that's why they're kind of waiting already almost to the last minute of saying, oh, okay, Broadway's official reopening date will be, God willing, June for, we don't know. But it ain't going to be April 13th, no matter what you're still seeing on all the websites for the Broadway shows. And unfortunately, really sadly, especially for off-Broadway shows that weren't even scheduled to start rehearsing until May, are being canceled or postponed. Or moved to the fall isn't as bad as being canceled, for sure. But it's so in flux. It's so up in the air while we get through this curve. And this curve has cost us three people related to the theater this week, and that's why on Inside Broadway it's kind of all sad news. I'm sorry about that, but kind of have to do it. First of all, Broadway lost Adam Schlesinger, or sorry, Schlesinger, age 52, from corona-related ailments. He was Tony nominated for co-writing Crybaby, the musical, a few years back with David Jaberbaum. He died of COVID on April 1st. Adam Schlesinger did. He's probably a bit better known for being one of the founding band members of the Fountains of Wayne and those folks who did Stacy's Mom, which was a big Grammy-nominated hit. He had quite a career, even if he's not a household name. He, and this is, again, sort of the sad part, he was working with Sarah Silverman in adapting her memoir, The Bedwetter, into a musical that they were going to do at the Atlantic Theater this coming season. Well, not only is Atlantic Theater thing, up in the air, but obviously that musical, Sarah Silverman will, I don't know how far along they've come with it, but she's lost her co-writer. He was also working with Rachel Bloom. She was the one who gave us My Crazy Ex-Girlfriend on adapting Fran Drescher's TV show The Nanny into a Broadway-bound musical. Lord knows what's going to be happening with that. And he was on Crazy Ex-Girl. That's how Rachel Bloom knew him. He wrote a lot of those funny, crazy songs that you heard on Crazy Ex-Girlfriend. He was Emmy nominated for that. He was never like EGOT material because he was more nominated than winning. But look at all the media he worked in. Emmy nominated, Grammy nominated, Tony nominated, pretty major guy. He was Oscar nominated for the title song of the Tom Hanks film That Thing You Do. But again, known probably most of all for Fountains of Wayne. And he also worked on that Monkees album Good Times, where they had that kind of a comeback album out of nowhere. He was on that as well. So a farewell To Adam Schlesinger, age 52, who passed away last week of coronavirus-related illness. And by the way, I just want to mention, I want to give a plug to a couple of things that help us do this Inside Broadway segment. TotalTheater.com is a free website on Broadway theater reviews, off-Broadway reviews, off-off regional theater, international theater. Now, there have been no new reviews for the past week or so. There's been nothing to review. But if you want to go and surf and look back at theater from the past like 15, 20 years, there's hundreds of pieces on there and articles and interviews as well. Just go to the homepage, TotalTheater.com, and surf to your heart's content. The search engine is kind of hinky, but there's a page that you can click that just says all the reviews, and you can search right on that page. And there's literally thousands of reviews on it from Broadway, off, and regional theater. So check it out. And the Periodica section has articles and interviews about theater from all over the world. It's TotalTheater.com. And then Total Theater also puts out a publication called Performing Arts Insider that has been the Bible of Broadway since 1944. Now, we did not put out a hard copy edition for April for obvious reasons. We did put out a PDF, a digital edition of Performing Arts Insider, and we're hoping that by June we'll be back rolling with this wonderful guide to theater in New York. If you want to find out more about it, please go to performingartsinsider.com and support the magazine, because that has been on its last legs for a while, and we don't want to see that go under too. So if you want to subscribe early and start getting issues like from June on, we would love to have you do that. Performingartsinsider.com is the place to find out more. Well, two more people to say farewell to in the neighborhood this week involving Broadway in our Inside Broadway segment. First of all, farewell to Patricia Bosworth, 86-year-old actress. She later turned a writer and biographer in her later years. She had a very, very difficult, speaking of an optimistic person, she came out of real dark times. Her father and her brother both committed suicide earlier in her life. And she was also, she got married really young, but then she came out of that and theater became this escape hatch for her. She took acting classes at the Actors Studio, where she took classes with Steve McQueen. She had a big crush on him, but he just wanted to be friends. By the mid-1950s, she was on Broadway. She had a small little ensemble role in the original Inherit the Wind, followed quickly by three Broadway flops in succession in the 1950s. The last one was a comedy called Howie, written by Phoebe Ephron, who was actually Nora Ephron's mother. Her last theater project for Patricia Bosworth was in 1978. Off-Broadway, she conceived a play called Choices for the Women's Project. I think it was a one-person show. Not sure about that. But anyway, she was more known for writing all these biographies of famous people, where she really dug in deep. They weren't like Kitty Kelly nasty-ish bios, but she did go towards the dark side of all these people because she understood it. Anyway, farewell to Patricia Bosworth, age 86, who passed away from corona-related illness this past week. Now, most of all, and saddest of all, for here in the neighborhood, we got to say farewell to someone that I didn't know personally, William Wolfe, theater critic and former Drama Desk president. He died of COVID on March 28th. He was part, the Drama Desk put out a release about this, he was part of the golden age of magazine journalism in New York. He was the film critic for Q Magazine. Q is what later morphed into New York Magazine. So William did a lot more film than theater for them because they brought John Simon in as their major theater critic, but he did both film and theater. He wrote a book about the Marx Brothers in 1975. He also did a volume of the Illustrated History of the Movies for Pyramid Books, which were these kind of paperback, easy to read, but they're not these giant historical tomes about movies. But I knew him, of course, much more for his theater stuff and for being president of the Drama Desk. He was this big, jolly man with this mane of shaggy kind of curly hair. Always so much fun to meet and talk to in the lobby at the theater. always so jolly about things. And it's not easy to do that when you're head of an organization that, as Keith Sherman was telling Rabbi Saul Solomon, that you're dealing with outsized egos and you're dealing with a bunch of critics in this case, which isn't always fun. And he always maintained this jovial, optimistic spirit about the theater. What else can I tell you about William Wolfe? He taught film. I think the first time I met him, he was teaching at NYU when I was going there for my undergraduate degree, and I kind of wish I took a film class with William Wolfe. I think I should have. Maybe I did. And I don't quite remember it, but he was probably an adjunct or maybe a full-time professor there, because people got to make a living in this business. And he in more recent years, he did that, he did the James Lipton kind of thing, where he taught a special actor studio type class at Lincoln Center, where he'd show a movie that hasn't been fully released yet, and he'd get an actor or the director from the film to come talk about it and answer questions after the movie. So, yeah, William Wolfe, another person taken from us. He was in, I don't have his age here, it had to be late 70s, maybe early 80s. So he certainly had a rich life as an entertainment journalist and educator. Not a bad life to lead, if you think about it. So a personal farewell to William Wolfe, and a farewell from the neighborhood and from Inside Broadway to him as well. Well, that's a fun way to end our segment, but we have more fun and happy things to do on the rest of this Dave's Gone By Facebookio, Podcastio, Programio of the stream here in the neighborhood. It is April 4th, 2020, so we're going to have our Today Yesterday quiz coming up. I don't know if my cousin Cynthia and Jeff or my cousin Mark are here tuning in, because we're not on our usual platform, we're not on our usual place on the Dave's Gone By Facebook page. We're here on the Miracle of Long John's page. But whoever is here, I will invite you over the next, in a couple of minutes, to play our Today Yesterday trivia quiz. That should be a lot of fun. It'll be all questions about April 4th in history. But before then, and before we get to our Colorado Limerick of the Damned, we do have another thing to do for you, and I apologize for this before. If I can apologize for the toilet plume song earlier in the program, I'm going to apologize for this. We used to do these week after week a couple of years ago, and then I kind of ran dry. The fountain, desiccated a bit. And then the past couple of weeks, I'm like, ooh, the fountain has a little burble here and there again in something that we call our Wretched Puns of Destiny. Now, these are little mini stories that end with plays on words that are so egregious and so awful that I kind of apologize for them, and I kind of don't. So we have our new Wretched Pun of Destiny for you. I don't think I printed it out, so I've got to do it this way. I thought I did print it out. Shame on me for missing that. Well, I'll just have to get it the old-fashioned way, haha, online. Just give me a moment, folks. Thank you for your patience throughout this entire broadcast. Wretched. And here it is. Okay, so our Wretched Pun of Destiny is going to be about darkroom equipment. That will be the gist of this horrible play on words that, as I said, we call the Wretched Pun of Destiny.
The Dave's Gone By Wretched Pun of Destiny.
Tone Loke, after his wealthy rap career in the 90s, was looking to expand his brand. Not realizing the digital age was around the corner, he decided to partner with Kodak on a range of photographic equipment. He gets an appointment with Kodak's chairman of the board, who at the time was dating Carole King. Now she's there for the meeting, and she listens to Tone Loke outline his plans for branding equipment like enlargers, magnifiers, and photo paper. The chairman of the board is on board until the rapper starts talking about darkroom chemicals. "Absolutely not," says the chair. People associate rap with drugs, so we're not putting the Tone Loc name on chemicals. That's crazy, says the rapper. I smoke a little pot, but no hard drugs, and I can sell tons of Kodak merch. He's right, Carole King whispers in the chairman's ear. He's got fans all over the world. I don't know, says the chairman. Tone Loc enlargers, fine. Tone Loc developing tanks, great. But Tone Loc silver bromide gelatin? Absolutely, Carole King sings out. Come on, baby, do Tone Loc emulsion.
We here at Dave's Gone By apologize for bringing you the wretched pun of destiny.
I told you I wasn't proud. I warned you. I said it would be horrible. Did I lie? Did I lie? Come on, baby. Do Tone Loc emulsion. Yeah.
That was a problem.
Yeah. As my wife says, that was a problem. That was difficult.
That was fake science.
Now, another segment of the show that I haven't done in a couple of weeks for kind of obvious reasons is Friends of the Neighborhood. Now, these are folks who have appeared on the program in months and years past. We like to check in on them and tell you what they're up to, what they're doing, because maybe they were in an off-Broadway show when they were on a program, and now they're doing a different show, or they wrote a book way back when, and now they've got another book. We think of them as family, as friends, and we like to let you know what they're doing. So these days, not everybody's doing
filming.
Not a lot of people are doing public stuff. You know, as Joyce said, basically we're all toilet pluming. So here's the deal, though: they are still working on things, a lot of them online. So we are going to do our Friends of the Neighborhood. So I'll just do a few of these, just to clue you in as to what they're up to. And some of these are just 6 degrees of unhappy news. For example, we have to send condolences to our friend of the neighborhood, Jessica Malasky. She lost her father-in-law this past week. Her father is a famous musician, Bucky Pizzarelli. She's married to John Pizzarelli. Bucky, now he lived to the ripe old age of 94. But he did pass away this past week of COVID. So farewell to him, and our condolences to Jessica Malasky and her husband, John Pizzarelli. In happier news, our Canadian friend from many years ago, Rob Szabo, has a new podcast. It's called And Sometimes Why. Why with the W-H-Y, great name. RobSzabo.com is the place to go see that. It's RobSzabo. RobSzabo.com. We never got to mention that Judy Collins put out an album in November called Winter Stories on Wildflower Records. So you're going to want to check that out. I'm sure you can get it on Amazon. You can buy it or stream it on all the different music services like Spotify and so forth. Judy Collins's Winter Stories album. Speaking of albums, a CD release happened this week because, hey, we can stream CDs. We can do music even through all of this. So Gerard Alessandrini's Anything Can Happen in the Theater, The Musical World of Maury Yeston, which I believe was a review that he put together for York Theatre Company. They have put out a cast recording CD on PS Classics, and it was released on April 3rd, which was just yesterday. So it's out there. Go get it. Anything Can Happen in the Theater. Want to clue you in that in just a couple of days, Eliza Gilkison, her new album called 2020, drops on Red House Records on April 10th. What are you the phone?
Yeah, I sent a call.
Oh, of course. Here you go. Thank you. Let's see. Linda Lavin. We were just mentioning her, I think. But Linda Lavin, she's one of these people, a Broadway person, who would be doing cabaret, who would be doing other things. She's got to stay home. She's got to isolate. So she and pianist Billy Stritch, in her house, or his, did a living room concert live on Facebook a couple of nights ago. Well, just like you can with this program, you can go to Linda Lavin's Facebook page, scroll down a couple of postings, and it's right there. You can watch it anytime. So do check that out. And by the way, we mentioned Bucky Pizzarelli, who passed away, the father-in-law of Jessica Mulaski. He is also connected in that 6 degrees kind of a way to Janice Ian, our friend of the neighborhood from a few years back. He played on her 8th album, Aftertones. Lloyd Cole, he misses Adam Schlesinger because he worked a bit on a couple of Lloyd Cole albums, including when Cole was doing his band The Negatives with our other friend Jill Sabuel. David Yazbek, well, he worked with the late Terrence McNally on the Full Monty. And, I'm just mentioning all these people who are affected tangentially by the people that they know, that they worked with, and people that we've lost to COVID. Speaking of things that will be happening but are postponed, the In the Heights movie, I'm sure they'll move that to the fall. Daphne Ruben Vega has a featured role in that film. You're going to have to wait for it. You will not have to wait for, and this is kind of cool, our friend of the neighborhood, Jane Sibbery. Now, she was doing, or going to do, once-a-week meditations live on Facebook. These are kind of mindfulness things, these take a breath, these get out of the horrors that we're in and just meditate with her live on Facebook. Those are saved on Facebook, and as a matter of fact, she's doing them not weekly, but nightly. You can join her on her Facebook page, Jane Sibbery. S-I-B-E-R-R-Y. One of the cool things that Broadway folks are doing, and let me just lower the music, it's a little distracting here, but our friend of the neighborhood, Alan Menken, is taking part in Broadway Online. And what it's doing is it's taking veteran Broadway actors and singers and composers and matching them with newbies. So people who are first starting out, who have real talent, and they want to ask advice from and get, you know, tutored by these people who have been doing this for many years. It's a great idea. It's Broadway, Bridge to Broadway Online. And Alan Menken is one of the people taking part in that. Frank Wildhorn is doing a series of home concerts at BroadwayWorld.com. You can watch those there. And I want to remind everybody, as we always do, that Evan Seplow is the editor of StageBuddy.com, which is all about New York nightlife. Dr. Demento, still doing Dr. Demento podcasts. I'm not sure if he's doing any new ones this past week or so, but his archives going back to the 1970s are available on his website, drdemento.com, for a small fee. Stuart Brown, this is a free place you can visit. He has a website called soundsofbroadway.com. It's a website of Broadway streaming show tunes 24/7. And plus they've started this Broadway trivia quiz that you can play. It's a lot of fun. soundsofbroadway.com. And Bob Cudmore, of course, podcasting about upstate New York history at bobcudmore.com. And those, my friends, are the friends of the Daverhood. It is about 10 minutes to noon Eastern Time here in the Daverhood. You're watching the Dave's Gone By Facebookio Podcastio Programio of the stream. And we still have our Colorado Limerick of the Damned to get to. But before we get to that, here's a fun segment that we like to do every week, and we've been doing it for a couple of months now, where we ask trivia questions about the date in question. Well, it is April 4th, 2020. So we're calling this Today Yesterday quiz going to be about April 4th in history. So what happened on this date 10 years ago, 100, 300 years ago? They're trivia questions, no fair Googling, no fair Wikiing or Binging. Check your noodles, see if you know the answers to some of these questions. Yes, ladies and gentlemen, we know there's an answer. I know there are answers to these things because I wrote them down. So please play along. Cynthia and Jeff, I know your son was battling COVID a week or two ago. I hope he's okay. Hope you guys are okay. I don't see you online here, but if you are, by all means chime in, or anybody who's watching, if you want to be the first to type in with the answer, that'd be really, really cool. And everybody can play against you in our today, yesterday quiz. I didn't bring in my xylophone, but I'll do the special, my special musical instrument for the day as we play along in our today, yesterday quiz. We begin, oh, I remember this year well, 1841. After just 1 month in office, then and you can play along too, but remember, give people a chance because we're on a delay here. After just 1 month in office, the ninth president of the United States died of typhoid. Who was he? Okay, shortest term of a president in history, 1841. So, you know, that'd be like a Jeopardy-like clue. If you knew the year and when the presidents were, this happened in 1841. After a month in office, the ninth president of the United States died of typhus. Who was he? So give it some thought, and anybody who feels like typing in an answer, we'll wait for a little bit. We'll instead of the question mark, we'll show our potato. La 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 boom, boom. Well done, Potato. That was very nicely done. So, who was the ninth president of the United States? Shortest presidential term in history. I'll give you a clue that his name was a three-namer. So it was blank, blank, blank. That may help. Hun, do you want to take a stab at that one?
John Jacob Jingleheimer Smith.
That's four names, but no, it wasn't John Jacob Jingleheimer Schmidt. Anybody want to take a stab?
Terence Cardinal Cook.
No, it wasn't Terence Cardinal Cook. Try another. I like these.
Catherine Deneuve.
Catherine Deneuve. With the apostrophe or without?
Without.
No, that's also wrong. No, the answer is, what's a president with three names? There weren't that many.
Oh, JFK. William Henry Taft, right?
No. There was another one. But you're two-thirds right on that one.
William? Murdoch.
No, not William Murdoch from Murdoch Mysteries. William Henry. Oh, like one of the Beatles he was.
Lennon?
No, there's three others. You'll get it.
McCartney?
No.
Star.
My sweet lord, no, you're wrong.
Oh, Hare Krishna. I thought that was Jackson. Mm-hmm. Oh, what's his last name? I don't know.
Good
his
lord.
Name.
No. What's this?
Hair?
What am I? All over
Harrison.
My body. Harrison! Yes, ladies and gentlemen, this is how we entertain ourselves during COVID. William Henry Harrison. Do you remember who succeeded him? Who was the 10th president of the United States?
I don't know. I can't. I'm exhausted. I can't think. You know?
Well, no. He was the vice president. He was, let's say, I can give you a tip on this one, or a tippy.
Ooh, Hendren. The birds. The bird Hendren.
No. It was John
bird,
Tyler.
Bird, but the bird, bird, bird.
Where is the word? It was John
bird,
Tyler.
Bird is the word, but the bird, bird, bird.
And what was interesting is they hadn't really planned for this. They hadn't figured a president would drop dead in office. So it wasn't actually clear when John Tyler took over whether he would still... Well, what has it been?
Bird.
When he took over, whether he would just take on the duties of...
Duties.
I said duties. When he would take on the duties of William Henry Harrison or actually become the president. And it set the precedent that he became president. So the answer was William Henry Harrison, who died today, April 4th, in 1841. All right, let's move on to our next question in our Today, Yesterday quiz. Born in 1922, April 4th, today, in New York, this composer and conductor went on to compose film scores for everything from the Ten Commandments to the Magnificent Seven to the Great Escape to Ghostbusters. However, maybe the greatest film score of all was also his, To Kill a Mockingbird. Can you name him? Okay. The second question in our Today Yesterday quiz. Who was it? Born today in New York, composer, also a conductor. And his scores for films included Ten Commandments, Magnificent Seven, The Great Escape, Ghostbusters, and To Kill a Mockingbird.
Ghostbusters. Do, 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 do.
Well, he didn't write that song, but he wrote the rest of the music.
Do, 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 do.
So, anybody want to take a stab on that one?
Ghostbusters.
Do, 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 do. Do, 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 do. I will say, for a hint, he shares the last name of another famous composer and conductor. I hope that doesn't give it, well, I hope it does give it away. Yeah. I've seen more game before. You want to try that one, babe?
Give it again.
So this film score conductor, I named some of his scores. He does share the last name of a very famous composer and conductor.
Oh, Bach.
No.
Beethoven.
Or forward. No. Nope, not Bach, not Beethoven.
No, I don't know. I don't know.
Want to give it a shot?
I don't know.
Oh, come on. You can glue this one together. That's a hint. Yeah.
Paste? I'm not good at this. Where's Cynthia?
Cynthia and Jeff are not chiming in. Anybody, by the way, if you want to type in an answer and play along, but you want to, I'll give it a couple more seconds. So, who is the most famous, well, one of the most famous orchestra conductors of all time?
Harry James?
Oh, well, that's more of a band.
I don't know.
Okay, well, the answer is, I mentioned glue. The first name is Elmer. And the second name, Bernstein. Elmer Bernstein.
Oh, that's a weird name.
How is Elmer? Well, kind of, yeah. But Elmer Bernstein, he wrote all the scores. He wrote the score for To Kill a Mockingbird that is so powerful and so memorable that even the TV commercials for the Broadway production, or what until a couple of weeks ago, what was the Broadway production of To Kill a Mockingbird, which doesn't have that music in it, which isn't connected to the film. In the commercials, they're using Elmer Bernstein's film music from To Kill a Mockingbird to promote the Broadway show. But and the thing is, Elmer Bernstein was not related to Leonard Bernstein, although they were friends. And what was kind of the fun thing is that Leonard Bernstein called himself East Bernstein and Elmer was West Bernstein because they worked on different coasts, and that's how they got people to tell them apart. Anyway, got a couple more questions in our Today Yesterday quiz where we move to 1932. Speaking of the movies, Born Today was this Oscar winner for a film called Friendly Persuasion. It was like his first or second film. But he's better known for playing psycho Norman Bates in the film of that title. Name the actor.
I know.
So give it a moment. Give it a moment.
I know him. I saw that on the. I was with Felicia.
Yeah. Oh, at the Universal tour. Because Psycho, I guess, was it Psycho a Universal film? I guess maybe. Anyway, so yes, who was this Oscar winner for Friendly Persuasion when he was quite young, and then got the role of a lifetime, which he sometimes hated because it typecast him forever. But he played Norman Bates in both Psycho and Psycho 2. There was a Psycho 2 a few years later. So who was that actor? I'm going to give it a second or two. And the answer is?
Jesus?
No, it wasn't Jesus. Who was the actor, babe? He said you.
Anthony Perkins.
Very good. Joyce definitely got that one. Tony Perkins was the actor. Did you know that? I didn't remember that. Tony Perkins dated Stephen Sondheim for a while.
What?
Seriously, yeah. He dated a lot of guys. This is the odd thing about Tony Perkins. In his 20s and 30s, he was, I don't know how open he was, but he dated a lot of men. And it wasn't until the second part of his life that he got into women and got married, and I think he even had a kid. So kind of interesting there. And usually it goes the other way. Usually they're in the closet.
Yeah.
And go with women, and then they discover they're gay and go live out the lives that they want to be. Perkins went the other way. Rather interesting. Okay, well done, honey. Well done. On to our next. We got the beat. Well, we're moving on to our next question in our Today Yesterday quiz. 1964, the year I was born. Born a couple months after me.
64.
Yeah. Born today, April 4th, 1964. What?
Oh, he's standing in the room there.
Wait, he's in what room?
I put him in his room.
Oh, okay, yeah. Born today, this bald, bearded stand-up comedian started with a wave of new comics at Catch a Rising Star, but is perhaps best known for his TV work. Those TV shows include The Ben Stiller Show, Mr. Show with Bob Odenkirk, and, most notably, playing Tobias Funke on Arrested Development. Name him. Okay?
Tobias Funke?
Yes, it's spelled F-U-N-K-E. Tobias Funke on R-Dev. So, can you name, in our Today Yesterday quiz, this bald, bearded stand-up comedian?
Say it again, Bobby Funke?
Tobias Funke.
Is that his real name?
The name of the character on Arrested Development that this comedian and actor plays is Tobias Funke. It's a hysterical character on a hilarious show. But he was also on Mr. Show with Bob Odenkirk. They were kind of a team at that point. And he was one of the rising comics with people like Janine Garofalo and Louis C.K. And playing Catch a Rising Star a lot. Who are we talking about? I will give a hint. Even though he was raised Jewish, he has an extremely Christian last name. Can you name this comedian actor? Potato, you're bald. Can you name him? Otatop does not concern himself with mass media. I apologize for that.
Very good.
So I'm going to give a countdown. Do you want to try this one?
I don't know that show.
Comedian who was born to Jewish parents, but has a very Goyish last name, was on R-Dev and all the seasons of R-Dev playing Tobias Funke, and also on Mr. Show with Bob Odenkirk, who went on to more fame and Better Call Saul. Anybody want to know? Well, the answer is David Cross. David Cross. And if you have kids, you probably saw him also in that first Alvin and the Chipmunks. I checked to see when people are born and what happened on certain dates. So David Cross, if you don't picture him, if you saw the picture of him, you know who I'm talking about. He was in the Alvin and the Chipmunks movie, and all his actor friends, you know, accused him of selling out, and or his comedian friends, and why did you take that film since you're kind of an undergroundy, out there comedian? And he said that movie paid for my summer cottage. It paid for allowing me to do all the other things I do. No regrets about being in the Alvin and the Chipmunks movie whatsoever. All right. Moving on to April 4th, 1967. Since so many people are filing for unemployment right now, let's look back at someone who quit a job today. This TV star left the show ostensibly to support a strike by the TV union AFTRA. But the star returned 3 weeks later after negotiating a pay hike to nearly $30,000 per week. Who was the star, and what was the show? So who quit his or her job today in TV, big TV star, and walked off because, AFTRA, the Association of TV Writers and Artists and folks like that, they were on strike, and it was a supportive measure. But while this happened, this person renegotiated this person's contract and spent 3 weeks away. Who was this person who then came back with a whopping raise? Want to take a stab, anybody? Any thoughts?
I don't know that.
I'll give a hint. This person did not have a weekly show. This person was on 5 nights a week. Any thoughts? No? All right, I'll wait for it. And then? The answer is, here's Johnny Carson.
Johnny Carson,
in solidarity with the other actors and directors and writers and stuff, walked off the show. And what happened was, apparently, this is the story, he, while he was off, NBC started broadcasting reruns of the show with him in it. And he said, hey, that's not in my contract. So he went and he brought his lawyers and ended up renegotiating his contract, which included a boost from making about $7,500 a week. And who can live on $7,500 a week? It's nothing. To $30,000 or just under $30,000 a week. So and he was supposed to come back in 2 weeks, but there was another show premiering in it, so he waited one more week. 3 weeks later, Johnny Carson was back on, you know, at that point, The Tonight Show. So that was the answer to that question in our Today Yesterday quiz. We move on 1 year later, speaking to world-changing, terrible events. April 4th, 1968. Hon, do you know your U2? Do you know your U2 music?
I do.
Sunday morning, April 4th. What happened?
Bono, I think, got plastic surgery.
Anyway, what happened in history on 1968?
They did that album where they were black and white on the cover.
That was the Joshua Tree. I think it's on there. Yeah. Or was it? It might have been on The Unforgettable Fire.
They did that. And they were dancing nudie pants.
They were not dancing nudie pants. No. We all know that on April 4th, 1968, shots rang out in the Memphis sky as Martin Luther King was assassinated on this date all those years ago. That is not the question. The question is, although many feel, or felt at the time, it was a conspiracy, one man took the fall. A convicted felon, an armed robber and forger by the name of who?
Anal.
No. You're still back with the toilet plume.
Toilet plume. Don't pop up on me.
So,
toilet plume, make me so happy.
Let me ask you, who do we feel, or who at least was convicted of killing Martin Luther King on this date in history back in 1968? Who was it? I'll give another second or two. Huh? You want me to take a thing?
Was it Jesus Christ?
No, although they share the same first initial. Want to give it a no?
Give it again. I lost it.
Who do we feel, whether it was a conspiracy or not, who was blamed for and convicted of assassinating Martin Luther King?
James Wilkes Booth.
Oh, almost! Mixing metaphors there, but no, James Earl Ray. And I misspoke. He was not convicted of assassination. He was, he took a plea deal rather than face the death penalty. So he always said it wasn't him. It was he was in the wrong place at the wrong time. Other people did it. A lot of people feel that was the truth and that the mafia was involved and LBJ was involved and whatever else. But James Earl Ray took the fall and he did not get the death penalty, but he did die in prison in 1998. A couple more questions in our Today Yesterday quiz here on Dave's Gone By. 1971, we move to April 4th. Taking the place of Connie Mack Stadium, a new $45 million venue opened, well, it was dedicated today, used for both baseball and football in Philadelphia. Kindly name the venue. What was it? It didn't start games today. It was just dedicated today in an official ceremony in your favorite city, Philadelphia, babe. What?
It was called Pretzel Town.
It was not called Pretzel Down. You're really twisting the questions this time. With some salty answers, but I'm glad you mustered the courage to say the yeast.
You're disturbing me.
I am. I'm disturbing myself.
Yeah.
So come on. You may know this one, even though you're not a sports fan. They needed a new, because Connie Mack Stadium was falling apart.
It was the, it's where the Philadelphia Fanatic is.
Right.
I don't know the name of it. I never went to it.
Neither.
Probably owned by Staples or somebody now. I mean, let's be real.
Well, think of your Uncle Bob. Mm-hmm. What was he?
Oh, Soldiers Field?
That's Soldiers a great Stadium? Answer. No, what's another name, though, for someone who was a soldier?
rookie?
In
private?
The military. In the,
a corporal?
Someone who served.
Enlisted? Veteran? Well, Veteran Stadium.
Veteran Stadium! Doggett, ladies and gentlemen, I don't know how loud this must sound on the thing, but yes, Veterans Stadium was dedicated on this day, April 4th, 1971. It had to hold both the Phillies and the Philadelphia Eagles. And the thing is, it didn't last that long. It was demolished in 2004. And isn't this horrible? I mean, think about it this way. First, it was Connie Mack Stadium.
That's beautiful.
Named after somebody, right? And then Veterans, named after veterans. And now, in modern day,
yeah,
the Philadelphia Phillies play in Citizens Bank Park.
Yeah, well, that's good. Bank on the money. Bank on the money.
And the Eagles play in Lincoln Financial Field. Now, nobody's going to have any kind of nostalgic.
It rolls off your tongue so beautifully.
I mean, even Citi Field has a certain feel to it in New York. I mean, that's a little better. But, you know, Yankee Stadium, Shea Stadium, these had. The Houston Astrodome, even.
It's just
Candlestick Park.
All they have is history, right? All
I know.
They have is history.
And what was kind of cool is back in 1971, the New York Times reported on the ceremony, the opening of the dedication of Veterans Stadium in Philadelphia. And it said that near the scoreboards, they have two huge dolls costing $40,000 each. And the dolls are wearing colonial costumes.
What?
And one is called Phil, and the other called Phyllis.
Oh, Jesus.
Honest to God. So whenever a Philadelphia Philly hits a home run,
oh, that's a problem.
Phil will bat a ball off a replica of the Liberty Bell.
Yeah, there you go. That's class.
To Phyllis.
That's class, honey.
While dancing waters sparkle.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's
yeah.
classy.
That's public money
that's
used in the right way.
That's
yeah.
classy.
And there's probably video of that somewhere. So anyway, that's that was the original Veterans Stadium, $45 million stadium back in the... Now, what would it cost? Probably cost like $800 million to build the same kind of stadium. Anyway, we've got two more questions in our Today Yesterday quiz here on Dave's Gone By. The year 1973. Speaking of opening dates for buildings... Today was the date for opening what was then the largest, well, the largest building in the world. What was it, and why is calling it a building deceptive? Okay, so the year 1973, they opened building, what was then, at that point, the tallest building in the world. I'm calling it the tallest building in the world. It makes it a little hard to think of the answer because that is a slight misnomer. Do you know why?
Why?
You want to take a stab at this one?
Why?
Think of the timeline.
Why?
Tallest building in the world, circa 1973.
Why?
Well, you want to give it a whirly gig?
It was the Sears Tower.
Not Sears, no. No.
Is it the Twin Towers?
Taller than the Empire State Building and whatever else was approaching it at that point. But here, the idea is, the funny part is, that the tallest building in the world was actually two buildings. It should have been the tallest buildings in the world. The Twin Towers were opened today in 1973 at the World Trade Center. So whatever happened to them?
I don't know. I think they're okay.
Yeah, me too. Mm-hmm. Anyway, we move on to our last question in our Today Yesterday quiz here on Dave's Gone By. We move all the way up to 1990. We're going to test your news IQ on this one.
Test my news IQ. The dog's starting to yowl.
Released today,
yowie,
after 22 months in prison, was this inside trader. Now, he inspired the Gordon Gekko character in the film Wall Street by championing the good part of greed. Can you name this white-collar criminal? Who was he? I wouldn't have remembered this one at all. This one would have stumped the hell out of me. But as soon as you hear the name, you'll probably remember. You'll know. So, yeah. I'll read that again. He spent a little under 2 years, really, in prison. He got a 3-year term, but he was given, or he spent just under 2 years in prison for insider trading. And they really wanted to make an example of him because, in terms of what he said and his character, eventually Oliver Stone made Wall Street and based the Gordon Gekko character on some level on this guy who gave a speech about greed being a positive
Oh,
thing.
that was Michael Douglas's character.
Right.
I don't know, was it a real person?
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. An insider trader. So, who was he? And he was released from prison on this date in
Was
1990.
Bernie Madoff?
Not Madoff, this is years before he even came up with his scheme, I'm sure. Who are we talking about? Nope, and not Michael Milken either.
Bernie
It
Madoff?
was.
Jesus Christ?
Let me put it this way. He shares a name with a terrible person.
Hamish?
Who's Hamish?
Hamish Hyman?
No. He's unfortunate, sad to say he's a Jewish guy, but no, but who is a terrible character from history?
Oh, and Hitler, Adolf. Adolf Eichmann?
Well, yeah, but he, Eichmann and Hitler,
Help me
no,
out.
I mean, they didn't have terrible in their names.
Oh, Ivan the Great? Ivan. I don't know
You
this.
got you got the
Ivan Madoff? I don't know who the stock people are about
released
this.
from prison today back in 1990, Ivan Boesky.
Oh, I would never have
Oh,
gotten
you
that.
remember Ivan Boesky? No. As I say, I was saying he was a Jewish guy and he made money, but he made millions of dollars because he was privy, and the talk is all about privies today. He was privy to inside stock tip information about all these companies, and he made all this money. Spent some time in prison. He was supposed to do 3 years. They gave him, well, that's what they gave him. He was out on good behavior after 22 months, and then lived a fairly quiet life after that. But the answer was Ivan Boesky, whose actual quote, by the way, it was not what Gordon Gekko said in the "greed is good," and the meaning is subtly different. What Ivan Boesky said was, quote, "You can be greedy and still feel good about yourself," which is different. Yeah, I mean, there's similarities, but it's
You
not.
know, it's like Marx that he says opium, you know, religion is the opium of the masses, and then people shorten it, and they, you know, everybody gets misquoted, right?
I write a song about toilet plumes. I know that will be misquoted
I
down the
love your
line.
toilet plume song.
Why, thank you,
It
darling.
was I shed a tear, but I think it was because you toilet plumed me.
I shed a tear down my legs when I was singing it.
I think you toilet plumed me, I
I
want to
did, I
say.
did. Anyway, you're watching Dave's Gone By with me, Dave Lefkowitz, my darling and adorable wife, Joyce. We're almost finished with the program. Joyce wishes we
Wow.
were finished with the program, but she knows and I know
What?
that we're still missing
Oh
an
no.
important component of, oh yes,
Oh no.
something that we can't do without on the program. Yes, we've been doing these for a couple of years now. These are short poems, 5-line poems about various towns, places, and municipalities in Colorado. We call them our Colorado Limerick of the Damned.
You're the poetry man.
A limerick is a comic verse of 5 lines, in which lines 1, 2, and 5 will end with words that rhyme. And likewise, verses 3 and 4 also end with words that rhyme. So this is a limerick.
Rocky Mountain.
Yes, ladies and gentlemen, our Colorado Limerick of the Damned, because Joyce and I lived in Colorado for several years, and so I started writing for no particular reason. Actually, I think the reason really was that I belonged to a writer's group that met once a month at our local library there, and there were times when I just had nothing in my mind and nothing to write. And I said, hey, let me do something really easy and simple and just write these stupid little poems. I think that contributed to it too, so I got something to bring to the group. But it just took on a life of its own, and I think I have about 90 or 100 of these little poems all about places in Colorado. So this week, oh my gosh, we go to Delhi, Colorado. And I do love me some Delhi, but
Jelly.
it's like the India Delhi, D-E LHI, Delhi, Colorado. It's an unincorporated community in Las Animas County in southeastern Colorado. I don't
Las
know.
Almas? I think it's Almas, no?
No, sorry, Las Animas, like anime, Animas.
Animas? Like,
I don't know, in southeastern Colorado. It's really known not for anything. It's got nothing there, although Terrence Malick, the film director, he shot kind of a legendary film called Badlands, and he has a scene there where he shows a boarded-up general store, and that is right there in Delhi, Colorado. It is also known as the only place left in Colorado with, and your dad would love this, a working wigwag railroad signal. Do you know what those are, Beb? It's the only place in Colorado left.
Oh, it has a person?
Oh, no, a wigwag train signal, like when a train is coming.
That's too bad.
And it's the pendulum thing. Remember how the things would swing down like that,
yes,
when a train was coming? Only place left that is still has a working
one.
I
don't think they got it now, big boy.
Well, yeah, I imagine they still do. This is new stuff. So Delhi, Colorado is the place where we are going for our Colorado limerick of the damned. Okay, well, the show will be over in a couple of minutes, and we'll take care of that then. But first, it's much more important that we do this poem, our Colorado limerick. And I do want to say, I don't know how many people are watching this time because we're on a different platform or any of that, but I will say that if you have children watching or listening, and you know, you want them to stay not just healthy of body and physically, but in mind and spirit, you probably want to get them away from the computer for the next five lines, because it is pretty disgusting and horrible. That's our
I'm
child.
I'm gonna go. Should I feed him?
Yeah, go. You probably don't want to hear this poem either. Okay. That's why Joyce is really escaping. It's not just to take care of our dog. So, ladies and gentlemen, Delhi, Colorado, for our Colorado limerick of the damned. Ahem. There was a young woman from Delhi who kept M&Ms in her belly. The men found it yummy to eat from her tummy. Who cared that her pussy was smelly? Yes, ladies and gentlemen, that was our Colorado limerick of the damned for today, April 4th, 2020. Send your comments, your complaints, your horrible, curse-filled emails to davesgoneby@aol.com. davesgoneby@aol.com. You can also, of course, message me anytime, not at this platform, not at Miracle of Long Johns, because until I do Miracle of Long Johns on stage again, I really don't check this site, but at my regular Facebook page, Dave's Gone By, which hopefully Facebook will fix and will start working again. I can go there, I can read your comments, I think I can reply to them, I just can't post anything there at the moment, and I don't know why, but it is Dave's Gone By, the Facebook page. Do check that out. Remember, you can go there and scroll down and watch the last... What?
Do you need the friends of the neighborhood?
No, I already did it. But thank you.
Do you want me to give him the pill?
Yeah, give him lunch. Thank you. So, yes, hopefully our Facebook page, our regular one, will be working. But even so, you can message me there. Send me all week long, not just during the show live. But I'll read stuff there. I will certainly read emails, davesgoneby@aol.com. Check out my Twitter feed, RadioDave2. It's Radio Dave and the number 2. And what else? Oh, and of course, our regular website, davesgoneby.com. Because not only can you watch the last couple of years of video programs there, and also we have audio, the audio too, but that website goes back all the way to our very first show in October of 2002. It was audio only, as were the first couple of hundred broadcasts, but they're all there for free. You can stream them, you can download them, and you can also, if you don't want to listen, let's say it's an hour and a half show. You know, if you want to start in the middle, it's got a little scroll thing, you don't have to listen to the whole thing. If you're waiting to hear an interview that we've done with someone amazing, you can go there too. It's all at davesgoneby.com. I know that some of the links here and there are broken. We're fixing them as fast as we can and as best we can, but more and more are working and working fine. davesgoneby.com. I want to remind you to check out Rabbi Saul Solomon's website, shalomdammit.com. Shalom, D-A-M-M-I-T. As I mentioned, that is the place where you can read and hear his old rabbinical reflections, you can watch his hilarious show that he did for Long Island Cable TV, and you can even see the early version of his stage show performed at the Richmond Shepherd Theater back, my God, 9 years ago. It's called Shalom Dammit, and it's all at his website, shalomdammit.com. He also has a Twitter feed at Rabbi Sol Solomon, at Rabbi Sol Solomon. I've got to do some thank yous. I've got to thank so much to Keith Sherman for being with us in the Daybreak and talking about his life and his health and being so positive in this crazy, very negative time. We certainly are glad that he and his husband are over their COVID, which I guess means that they'll never get COVID again. Maybe, you know, Keith, if you can toss us a little blood our way. I'm really afraid of needles, so I'll just drink some that'll give me the antibodies so I won't get it, my family won't get it. But yeah, glad that you're feeling much, much better. Glad that your hubby's okay, and glad that you're thinking forward and hoping and planning for more shows and concerts and events to represent in the future. We thank Keith Sherman so much for being with us on Dave's Gone By in the Daverhood. I want to thank my darling and wonderful and adorable wife, Joyce, for helping with the show as she does every week and joining us as part of the program. And you know, especially when things aren't going right in the early part, and I'm having technical troubles, I'm yelling and abusing her, and I'm like, but this is, oh, I can't think of this now. But I really, really very much appreciate all the help and love that she brings. And I certainly appreciate all the folks who tuned in, whether you're watching live on this Saturday, April 4th, 2020, and you've joined us on this particular Facebook page, or whether you're watching this later on. We'll try and post this on my other Facebook site so that you can watch it and get it as soon as the other Facebook site is working again. Either way, whether it's on this page or my regular Dave's Gone By Facebook page, we should be back next Saturday, I guess that makes it April 11th, with the 741st episode of the Dave's Gone By Facebookio, Podcastio, Programio of the Stream. Our guest is scheduled to be Annie Golden, veteran actress of a little post the golden age of Broadway, but she was in the movie version of Hair, and she's done a ton of off-Broadway and Broadway shows, so it should be so much fun and interesting to talk to Annie Golden about her life, her career, and the theater that we all love and miss. Well, I love you for tuning into the show, and don't miss the next one. Next Saturday, 9 to noon, or thereabouts, we will keep you posted no matter what at my website, davesgoneby.com. Do be sure to visit there and check that out. Until then, until next week, as everybody is saying right now, stay safe, stay healthy, and by gosh, avoid those toilet plumes. Oh, perfect timing. So I just said so many nice things about you on the show, and thank you for all your help.
Uh-oh.
As we leave the neighborhood for this week. Oh, yeah. It has not been a happy month, but...
Oten Top has now... He's a king. He's dedicating this as the new year.
Maybe by this time in either... certainly by January, or maybe by the next Jewish New Year, Oten Top will be able to bless us with a much, much happier time. And Gone By.
Dave's gone by. They're gone by. Dave's gone by. They're gone by. Dave's gone by. They're gone by.
Feel good, everybody. See you soon, and gone by.